Tuesday, April 11th, 1995 is now called to order. First item on the agenda is adjustments to agenda. Are there any adjustments? Next item is approval of school board minutes, first for the meeting of March 14th, 1995. Were there any changes or corrections? Charlie, did you have anything on the minutes?
No, I don't.
Okay. Okay, and the second was the special meeting on Tuesday, March 28th. Any changes? Okay, the minutes stand approved. The next item is comments by high school representatives. By Pat.
Hello, my name is Pat Cotter. I'm the SAC rep for the school board, and I'm a senior. Jen couldn't be here tonight. She's studying. Right now, the SAC is in the midst of rewriting the Constitution, which is a very large undertaking, because we have to double-check and check everything to make sure all the wording's correct. It was last done in 1984 when there were about 100 students more in the school, so it needed to be rewritten. The seniors, you walk into the high school, first thing you'll see is our very large marker board that says 34 more days left. Everyone's ready, getting ready for graduation. The juniors have been busy working on their final preparations for the prom, which is May 9th. They're just double-checking to make sure that everyone's booked and everyone's happy with what's going on. The sophomores are planning three retreats coming up in the next few months. They're offshoots of the freshman retreat. The freshmen and natural helpers are also planning their freshman retreat, and the freshman retreat is basically a retreat that deals with a lot of different things everywhere, from suicide to drug abuse, things to do with your time in high school and how to maybe work. It's more social, what's going on socially with the kids. It's more or less run by the natural helpers, which for anyone that doesn't know, natural helpers are chosen by the students. They're students that people feel they're all different students. They feel that they can, students elect them, I believe it's two each year. And basically it's students that you can talk to and you feel secure talking to. The junior, sophomore, and freshman just had, about a week ago, had a semi-formal, $800 were raised. It was kind of funny watching everyone dress up that normally doesn't dress up. And Mr. Fusco sitting next to the door, making sure everyone had a tie on. And sports, softball has been just started and is getting ready for the season, which begins in about a week. Lax just beat Waynefleet today. We don't know how much because they stopped keeping score by the time they got about 10 goals ahead. Baseball had a double header. They went 1-for-1 on Saturday. Track is trying to get used to their morning practices, which begin at about 6 o'clock, which means you have to wake up at 5:30. And they're getting ready to, almost everyone except for me, is getting ready to run in the Patriots Day race on Monday, which is a 2-miler, and it's sort of a weird tradition. Tennis has just finished a candy sale. This is for a wind curtain, which will go all the way around the fence, which makes, I'm not a tennis player, so I don't know what this means. Someone just told me this, which make the ball play easier, whatever that means. This will also help all the residents that use the tennis courts when the tennis team is not using them. Are there any questions?
No. Thank you, Pat. Middle school representatives.
Hello. We'd first like to start to congratulate our seventh graders, algebra students, for their recent performance in the New England Mathematics League Math Contest. Out of the 281 New England schools that participated, Cables was tied for eighth place, and the overall team score of 179 placed them in first in the region and first in the state of Maine, so we're really happy about that. And we've been doing a fundraiser for humanity t-shirts, and we just ended that a couple days ago, and we haven't had our profits yet, but overall we did pretty well. And on Friday 28th, we have a 7th and 8th grade dance. And also we have a social coming up on May 5th at the high school.
Okay,
The Wednesday after vacation, the eighth grade is going to the Portland Expo for Career Fair. In the first week of May, the fifth, sixth, and seventh graders will be taking the achievement tests. On this coming Friday, some fifth grade classrooms are moving back to the portables. The classes that are moving are Mr. Earl, Mrs. Parker, Mr. Smith, and Mrs. Sloan. The sixth graders are going to Chewonky in May, and this week is foreign language week for the middle school. And on Thursday, the group Inca Son is coming to school to perform for us. And spring sports started up, and games will start after vacation. And last, we have enjoyed having the fourth graders with us, and they are now moving back to the Pond Cove building. Any questions? Thank you.
No, thank you. Okay, the next item is communications. Lonnie, it's you.
Yes. I noted in your packet you have a copy of a grant that Susie Terrian, our middle school art teacher, wrote, and the letter telling of her award. So I thought you'd be certainly pleased to see that. I was going to say Susie's work itself is beautiful, and the work we see from her students, I think, is always impressive. So I thought you would enjoy seeing what she herself is doing. And since I sent the packet out, we've received an award. I think Connie just put these out as extra communication. Another middle school teacher, Dana, has been awarded or selected to participate in the sixth Summer Institute on Spanish Language and Culture, which happens to be held in Spain. So she is going there this summer and is obviously quite excited about this, and had come in to talk about it, hoping that she would be accepted. Personally, I thought she probably would, and am very happy to see that she has. So there's some of the details there. And the third piece that I also included in the packet, you may recall it, we had a discussion earlier, Kelly Hassan's sabbatical, and I'm very happy to tell you that she can now go on sabbatical because she has, in fact, been accepted to the master's program at Harvard. So congratulations to all three of our teachers. And that's the communication update.
Okay. Anybody else? Okay, moving on to superintendent's report.
And we're going to start with the MEAs. And Lyle is here to explain the report again that was in your packet. And I also included some other information that I thought was sort of background. So why don't we start with Lyle, and then any comments or questions or comments on any of the other things that I included, we can have a chance to discuss it.
Okay. Good evening. If it's okay with you, I will kind of go through the report, highlight the, kind of do a summary of highlights, and you can ask any questions as I go along, or you can save them for the end. This year we had a large percentage of the students who took the test. Three students were totally eliminated, and then two other students did not take the math section. And that was in part because the math test was much more difficult this year, and the people who didn't take it simply could not have started to approach taking the exam. The overall scores were very strong. Three scores increased from last year, two decreased, and one remained at the top score of 400. On the chart at the bottom of the first page, you can see that our reading score this year was a scaled score of 365. The writing score was 365. Math was 400. Science was 375. Social studies was 350. Arts and humanities was 335. And this year they added a test in the area of health, and our score there was 320. Most of those scores, the first five scores, place us within the top 2% of schools across the state. That's illustrated in a graph that I have attached to the end of this report. Each year, I report on the differences in gender, and an interesting thing happened this year. In the past, usually boys outscore girls in the area of science and social studies. They usually are pretty even in math, and the girls always do much, much better in reading and writing. This year, the test was based on all open-ended response questions, as you probably have heard by now. And that, I don't know if that is the reason for the switch in scores based on gender, but you can see that the boys lost out to the girls in the areas where they've been stronger by a significant amount. And when you compare the fact that the boys were outscored a great deal by the girls, and combine that with the fact that they were far ahead of the girls last year, the difference is up in the 100-and-some-odd points, which is 2 standard deviations, which for those of you who know anything about statistics know that that's just a huge, huge difference. It'll be interesting to see what kind of pattern emerges in the 4th and 11th grades and to see if that continues in future years. If you look at the state gender differences, you will notice that a similar pattern happened all across the state, where the girls outscored the boys in every area except math, and that was real close. The other thing that I should point out is that because the scores are reported differently this year, when I make those comparisons of gender, the first 3 tests are reported in terms of percent that achieved an advanced or above rating. And that's the way the state reports it out, so that's the way that I have to report it to you. The other 4 scores, the science, social studies, humanities, and health, those scores are still reported to the school in terms of scale scores. And that's the reason that there are 2 different kinds of scores there. Following that comparison, I have done a comparison of our special services students. They are compared to others within the school, and then I have a comparison of our handicapped students to, in Cape Elizabeth, to other handicapped students across the state, and you can see the differences there. The state advises us that we should not compare one grade to another for a couple of reasons. First of all, the tests, even before they were changed as significantly as they are this year, there are significant changes each year in the test, and the grouping, the numbers that are tested for the same time between 4th grade and 8th grade changes by about 25 or 30%. So we really are not supposed to compare 4th grade scores to 8th grade scores for the school as a whole. But if you do that, you will notice that the 8th graders scored a lot higher this year than students scored in the 4th grade as a whole. As I say, keep in mind that this is a different test and a somewhat different population, so it's not quite fair to make a one-on-one comparison. And that increase, by the way, is pretty typical that will happen, that has happened historically each year. The rest of the information that I've presented in your report this year is additional information. One of the things that I wanted to point out to you is that the raw score resulting that produces different kinds of percentile scores between the tests are significantly different. In other words, X amount of points in reading gives you a very different score than the same amount of points in math. And to point that out, what I did do is give you an order of the raw scores and the equivalent percentile scores that those raw scores produce. And you can see, for instance, that 10 raw scores, 10 points out of 32 gives you a 5 percentile in reading, whereas the same 10 points out of 32 puts you above average at the 52nd percentile in math. And even if students receive a score of 50% correct in reading, that results in a 35 percentile score in reading, whereas if the students got half of the credit available in math, it would put them at the 85th percentile. The one other thing that I wanted to do is to show you the letter that goes home to parents so that you will notice, too, that when the state talks about percent of students who scored in the novice category, the basic, advanced, or distinguished, that those percentage of categories in each test is not equivalent either. As a matter of fact, the state report that was released to the paper made a misstatement, or else another statement that they sent to me was misstated. If in reading, for instance, it was reported that the top 2 percentile scores of students who scored in the 98th and 99th percentile score received a distinguished rating, when in fact only a percentage of the students who scored in the 99th percentile received a distinguished rating. So many of our students actually scored at the 99th percentile, which is the top 1% across the state, and they still only received an advanced rating. Whereas in math, 2% of the students who scored at the 98th and 99th percentile did receive a distinguished score in math that was reported correctly by the state to the newspapers. The other thing that concerns me is that in compiling these scores, advanced systems in the State Department of Education have kept to a very pure statistical kind of reporting, which results, I think, in a gross unfairness and a gross inequity to our students. For instance, if a student in reading scored at the 78th percentile, about half of the students who scored at the 78th percentile in reading received an advanced rating, and about another half scored it and it was rated as a basic score. And it doesn't explain any of that in either the letter or any of the materials that I received. So what I called advanced system, they explained to me that in arriving at the percentile scores, they develop a master rank order list, and the cutoff point was at the 78th percentile. And when they got to deciding which students go into which category, they came up with some kind of a rating weighted system and graded some questions as more difficult than others and awarded a little bit more credit for getting the same score on one question compared to the same score on another question. So half of our students who received a raw score of 21 received one rating while the other half received another. And as it turned out, the profile of a student who received a 4 ended up with a basic rating. And the student who didn't receive a 4 and received nothing but 2s and 3s on the individual test questions ended up in the advanced category. The other thing that's disturbing, I think, with that is that if you look at the copy of the letter, you will notice that it says your child received and they give a percentile score for the score that the child earned. And then there's a little arrow. And for half of the students, the arrow, for the students who received the exact same score, the arrow was about a quarter of an inch into the advanced. And for other students who received the exact same score, the arrow was moved about a half an inch, or as much as a half an inch back into the basic, even though it was the very same score. The other thing, so at least they have a rationale for that part of it. The other part of it is that makes it even worse is when they looked at a student who had received congruent scores. In other words, if two students received the same score on the first question and second and third and fourth and through the 8 questions, then half of those students, and you do this statistically, but you don't do this in awarding credit for tests, half of the students were given a basic rating, and half of the students were given an advanced rating based on random selection. Now, that's compounded, and I've talked to Superintendent Goldman about this, and what we are doing is holding the stick-on labels that go onto the permanent records, because that problem is made even more, I think, serious, because if you look at that reading basic score band, the permanent record score band refers only to basic or advanced. So for a student who gets the exact same score as another student, is the permanent record looks like that student scored somewhere between the 25th and the 75th percentile. The student with the same score, another half of our students who receive the same score, will have a permanent record that indicates they scored in the advanced range, which will give you a range of approximately 78th to 99th percentile score. And that's based on simply random sampling. And I think that you folks should be aware of that, and not many schools in the state, I don't think, are aware of that, but that's what I've been able to find out after being confused by some of the scoring and calling advanced systems. So that kind of wraps up my report.
Are they planning to solve this problem? Do you know? Did they indicate that they were aware that this was a problem in terms of dealing with actual human beings rather than just
they statistics? Presented a great rationale as to why it's done statistically. And I explained that I thought that when you're dealing with students and human lives, that if once a person receives a cutoff score, then you award that score from that point on and don't worry about the statistical way that you arrive at that particular score. But they don't see it that way. And it's not untypical of some of the responses. I know I've talked to some people, both staff as well as superintendents as well, and university people, who have inquired about these kinds of things, and to some extent they've not received full answers from the people that they've been talking to.
Thank you, Lyle. I mean, I want to communicate to the board that Lyle's done a lot of work on this, because we've talked on several occasions, not only about the eighth grade, but also the fourth grade test. And I've been to some meetings and have a couple more slated, I think, in early May, and another one middle May, with groups of advanced systems and State Department people, as well as interested, a couple of interested superintendents who've been trying to be helpful in all of this. I think that Lyle's given you as good a picture as we know. It really is a picture of a situation where a state assessment test has made some major changes. I personally would have been happier had they started at the very beginning saying that this is a pilot year. We had one set of problems crop up in the fourth grade just with the type of test and its effect on fourth grade students. We didn't have that same effect at the eighth grade level, but when you look at the results, you can see, I think it charitably, the results are not crystal clear. And that we don't know exactly what these results tell us. Furthermore, when you get into some of the discussions with people who are doing the scoring or at least have some connection, it's very obvious that it's a new process for them too, and there are stories behind the stories behind the stories. This may well turn out to be, in essence, a pilot year, that some pieces of this remain pretty much the same kind of indicator that we've seen in the past. But I think that issue of the changing to open-endedness and what that does on the gender differences that we've noted at the fourth and eighth grade in particular, the early language acquisition of girls, which tends to give them we've been looking at it as an issue for boys at the primary level. And when I saw those your comments on that and the effect, that's a fascinating piece, and I will certainly make sure it gets to these discussions that I'm a part of. But I just want to emphasize that I have told people at the state level that we are not putting these stickers into the permanent record until we have a little better sense of what that might mean, because we're not satisfied that this is yet at a point where we want that to happen. It may not mean too much one way or the other. The scaled scores are fairly predictable, but there is just enough experimentation going on here so that we're not really comfortable with that. Yeah. I did include in your packet a copy of the article. Well, I gave that to you too, didn't I?
You're going to.
I'm going to. Sorry, because it's important for you to have that too. I'll give you my copy. Because, and I don't know if you have any responses to that, but I thought that was one of the better summaries I'd seen, thank you, recently of, Maine is not the only state that's trying to introduce a more sophisticated way of challenging students in assessment, which I think is a certainly very understandable predictor of what should happen if we try to raise standards. On the other hand, when you try to be objective in the grading of subjective material, you have some problems that are hard to anticipate, and I think that's what we're seeing now.
Just Charlie. a couple questions. One was health issues, a new subject area tested. What type of questions or subject areas? I didn't bring my copy of the MEA, so. I was just interesting, there seems to be almost a 100-point difference between boys and girls, and it would be interesting to know, by eighth grade, you would hope that they had some understanding of health issues.
I don't know, do we have
it? I have a few samples of those in my office, if you want to. I can make copies and send those to you, or you can come by and look at the whole packet of sample questions with sample responses.
But it seems to be the biggest gender gap difference. And it was a new test, a new tested area for the first time. But I don't remember any new test area when they've been added to have that wide a gender gap.
Yeah. Charlie, do you have any more questions?
I had one other question. An observation from the published newspaper MEA scores for eighth grade and the listing of the number of novice, basic, advanced, distinguished. Again, I think it does a disservice to students because that's what you focus in to look at what number of students you have that are advanced and the number of students in the state. And, you know, it was almost geographical to see. And I think that does a disservice to the whole test.
I had a question about the math score. Obviously, we scored at the 400 level, but when we look at the performance levels, the majority of our kids are at the basic level with 17 each at the distinguished and advanced. And I know we talked a little bit, I know Nancy threw out a while ago, you know, what does this mean? Does this mean our kids aren't understanding in depth or don't know how to apply it? Do we have any sense of that yet? Or what that means to, you know, the school score is 400, but then to have the majority of kids at the basic level?
I think that the answer to that lies in, were the people who judged those questions to be at that level accurate in their judgment? There are two, three problems from my perspective with that process. You see, one of the problems is we don't have a state curriculum. And in order to make this process the most productive, you should start with a given curriculum and given expectations from that curriculum and define certain goals that should be achievable. And because we don't have some of those at the state level, we don't have some of those basic givens, what has happened is the state has put together a panel to rate these responses to those and put them into those different categories. And I think that it's interesting. Well, let me just leave it this way. It's interesting that on another test, the National Assessment of Educational Progress, for instance, the state of Maine has scored the highest in the country. in that particular test. And that's a multiple choice question test, and by some people would be rated as good, and by other people much inferior to this particular test. And we are really one of the best schools in math in the best state in the country in terms of math achievement. And that's what our results look like. Either the national, and I think that what they're trying to do is show that even though we are the best, we're the best of a poor lot. And some, you know, testing of industrialized nations tend to support that. And I think that it's fair to ask the question of the people who made that judgment that those four criteria represent those, you know, I think there's some question as to how accurate were those people in saying that those questions rated those particular levels, especially if you're doing it with a test where the average two items in that math test had a statewide average score of 0.6 and 0.7. That means that two of those eight questions that were used to arrive at those scores and produce this data, probably only about a quarter of the students across the state could get any kind of response to those questions at all. Because when you have a 0.6 average score out of a possible four, that means that the schools across the state, you know, the students were responding at about 12%. And half of the questions received a score of approximately an average of one. That means half of the questions on the test, the average score was one out of four, or 25%. When you have a test that is that difficult, and you're relying on data where kids are able to produce only one-fourth of what is expected on the average, I don't think that you really have a very good instrument. And what you're doing is looking at a very low achievement level and making a lot of judgments, I think, based on little evidence of performance. The fact that you only have eight questions to begin with is an issue, I think. The other issue is that they are so very difficult that very few kids can achieve. It reminds me of when I was in some of my tough science and math courses in high school and college where, you know, you were given a test and if you got 10% right, that was probably a C, and the kids who got a 30% right got an A. And I don't think that that's a very legitimate way to test, quite frankly. But I think that there's some real problems with making a broad brush sweep based on that limited response, that limited number of questions, to say the state has, or the RA school system has X number of kids who are performing at the novice level, and et cetera. The other problem is that there's little gradation to these questions. To me, a more adequate test would ask some basic questions and some very difficult questions and some questions that where students are asked to operate at a higher level thinking skill level, so that you can say, well, these kids, you know, X number of kids got the basic questions right, but they broke down when they went to a higher level. The problem from my perspective is when you ask all your questions at a very difficult, higher level thinking skill kind of level, when they don't do it, all you know is that they can't think at that level, but you don't know at what point that learning process begins to break down. And I think that that's a serious shortcoming of this test.
I just had one more comment about the gender gap. I guess what it said to me when we saw that 101 or 132 point change in science and 101 points in social studies, the reversing of the gender gaps that you commented on, that we have created a very gender biased test. now, and...
No, I didn't say that.
No, that's what, I guess that's what I interpreted from it. And it's interesting that we look at this testing so that we can have a measure, maybe, of what goes on in the classroom, or we can take this back and use this information to help us in the classroom. And I guess it, to me, I would like to know if the teachers felt, from what they see every day, that there are these gender gaps in the classroom. And because it seems like you can't rely on the test, that maybe multiple choice, there's a gender gap towards the boys, and these open-ended, that there's a gender gap towards the girls, and just answering the questions. But it doesn't really help us with the knowledge and what, where's, if there is a gender gap in the actual content area. But it'd be interesting to hear from the teachers if they see it in the classrooms.
Have there been many comments from eighth grade parents or students about these scores? I know Connie had asked in her notes, so she'd be interested to know if we've heard anything. I didn't hear anything from anybody. And I'm wondering, do people understand the problems with the test? Or, I mean, have we done anything to explain? I know this is kind of complicated stuff, but is it worth trying to share it with parents in some kind of way, or are they not showing any interest?
Right now, we haven't had a lot of questions.
Yeah.
But we had talked about maybe after the fourth grade series gets back and the 11th grade series, but perhaps advanced systems can give us some better answers as well, too, than to talk to the K-12 unit about what the tests mean. I think right now, basically what we have to do is talk with the parents, as Lyle spoke with you, that we're not exactly sure what some of these results mean. They raise a lot of serious questions for us. In fact, so serious we're not even going to put the things on the permanent records yet. So at this point, I'm afraid we might confuse people more than we would help them understand. And we have received very few calls. How many people have you talked with?
Probably three or four people. My major inquiry centers around, my child achieves at a very high level, or is in an honors level course, and the scores were at the basic novice level. And in a couple of situations, question, you know, I think the timing is terrible for this kind of result to come back, because if it's misleading at all, it's at a time when they're making their high school course selections. And two or three questioned if they should, you know, challenge themselves with the advanced courses, because they're being told that they're basic and novice kind of students. And they question if they should get themselves into a high level course. So that's where I think this, you know, really, when you look at the cutoff points between those percentile points and realize that one question moves you up about 6 or 7 percentile points, and you have that kind of variation, and the same percentile point will move you from one dramatic score to another very different score, it's basically not right for the student.
Yeah, I guess I feel uncomfortable just leaving it that we know that these aren't going to go on the permanent record right now. Could we do just a short memo to the parents saying, you know, there's some statistical anomalies here, so that, you know, just basically what you said, I think it can be said in kind of a simple way so people know, you know, how the system is approaching it as far as not putting the labels on it, and that, you know, there's still stuff going on with this, but, you know, it's not finished. Your kid hasn't been labeled at such and so a level.
I could put together a short note that we could put into probably the trimester grades are going on.
The progress reports are going on April 28th, so we could put them
on. I think it might be worth doing that, because I think even if people haven't, you know, called about it, I think if they haven't been paying attention to the paper and there's been nothing about this particular issue, I think we might as well share it with them, where it stands and how, you know, how you're dealing with it.
The parent letter is a little better because at least they get the percentile kind of score.
Right.
The problem is when that score is taken away, and what we've done there is, because for instance, this is a time when a fair number of eighth graders make application to private schools.
Mm.
And what we've done is to say that those are not part of the permanent record, but if you want to see the percentile part of that, you can ask the parents for their report.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Keith, did you ask me?
I was wondering about the scoring. the parents and the paper and so forth, and these reports publish both the old numerical scoring and the new category scoring. When is the old numerical scoring going to go away? Or is it not? Is it always going to be somehow interpreted over to the numbers?
I think that's up for debate. I don't know that. I've heard that in workshops I've gone to put on by the state, I've heard that this is a transition year and that they're going to report on both. But at that time, they didn't. I don't think they anticipated the kind of reaction that they have received. And I think that is open to question at this point, just where this all will go. And I think the intention was to go to all of the category reporting in a few years, especially for those. But that's, you see, that is for those three scores where individuals receive scores, individual students receive scores. See, I don't think that there was ever any intention of giving those reporting percentages of students in reporting categories in the areas of social studies, science, arts and humanities, and health. Because there, a student receives only two questions. And they do what they call cross-matrix sampling. That means that there are 12 forms of the test. Each form has two different questions, so there's a total of 24 questions in the whole test. And the only thing that you get there are school scores, and as far as I know, those will still remain as the scaled score kind of scores.
Yeah, that was my point. I'm concerned that the old scoring system really can't effectively score a test that's not designed for that type of scoring system.
Well, there certainly is going to be an ongoing conversation, and I will try to keep you updated as I know more, but I think probably that's, this is it. This is the picture as we know it at the point this time. Thank you, Laura.
Thank you
very much. Second item is update on the construction project. And Sue is here to catch you up to date. Obviously, we've already heard from the middle school that they're waving goodbye to the fourth graders. It's nice to know that they enjoyed having them around. And I'm sure they're all envious to get into the portables, right?
That must be it.
Must be. Of course, the eighth graders aren't balls.
Well, we are planning to move, if everything goes according to plan, beginning Thursday afternoon. There are a couple of clearances that we have not received yet, the most significant being the hookup of the permanent fire alarm, and that is to occur on Thursday morning. And the fire chief and Mr. McVeigh are supposed to do their walkthrough on Thursday afternoon. So, assuming that all goes well and we receive a certificate of occupancy, we will proceed with the move beginning at 4:00 on Thursday. There don't appear to be any glitches or major issues as we had before with phase one, so I'm assuming that things will go according to schedule and we will in fact move. The format for the move is, and just for the listening audience, the fourth graders moving into what was the administrative section of Pond Cove, or what we call Area B at this time. There are 8 classrooms there, so the fourth grades will be moving into those. I believe there are 7 fourth grades, and then there are a couple of special ed spaces and meeting rooms that will be available. How it's going to happen is that our staff will be moving everything Thursday night. We just plan to back the truck up to the front of the 30s building, empty it into the classrooms. As I speak right now, those classroom floors are being cleaned by our own staff. I was over there about 5:30, and they looked very good. So they're stripping them down. They will apply the sealer, 2 coats of wax, and burnish them. What we are going to delay is the doing of the hallway floors and the bathrooms until the move has actually occurred. So that will be happening basically over vacation, so that we're not messing up everything that we have cleaned. So if you have an opportunity to be in there on Friday, the hallways will not be done yet. So we hope that you'll wait and pass judgment the first day back after vacation. What's going to happen with the fourth grade students on Friday is that they will be dropped off at the Pond Cove School. So if they're coming in on the buses, there will be no stop at the portables at the middle school. So fourth grade drop-off will be at the Pond Cove locations. That means parents driving their children should drive to the rear parking lot behind the middle school where the new Pond Cove walkway goes across to the Lunt building. Early in the morning, the fourth grade students will be visiting first and second grade classrooms. And they're going to spend a fair amount of time. I think each room has adopted a first grade classroom, and they'll spend some time there, and then they'll move on to a second grade classroom from there. They will be going to their allied arts at the middle school, and on Friday they will have their last lunch in the middle school cafeteria. So nothing will change in terms of where they're going to eat. After lunch, the students will be brought to the fourth grade area of the Pond Cove School and set up their rooms. By then, the teachers will have had 3 or 4 hours to work in their rooms so that when the students arrive sometime after lunch, they'll spend the rest of the afternoon there and then depart on the buses at 3 o'clock. So that's it for the fourth grade. As soon as those fourth grade rooms are emptied, our staff will be going in and cleaning them so that on Friday we can begin to move the fifth graders out of the connector link and a couple of the rooms that are adjacent to where the new elevator is going to go. The middle school plans to involve the students quite a bit in the move, where they're not having to go very far. Some are just going up the stairs or across the hall or just out the door and across the bus loop. So they will be moving some of their own items during the day. So I suspect they'll be spending some of the day in their old fifth grade classroom and maybe spending some of the day in their new home. When they depart for the day, our crew will come in once again and finish up all of the large pieces that need to be moved. And we really don't know what that will be until we get there. I suspect some of the rooms will be completely done. I suspect there will be others where there are some large articles that we have to move. So at that point, the link will be emptied, and as of Saturday morning, I don't think they start with that demolition until Monday, but on Saturday morning, they will start with the demolition of the two outside walls of the now middle school administrative wing. You'll remember over the February vacation, they did the outside walls of the IT wing. They built new walls, took the window walls out, and put up new walls. Well, we'll be doing that in the administrative wing on Saturday, April 15th. All of those walls, window walls, will come down. What we have done is we have hired round-the-clock security to be there from the time the workers finish on Saturday until they return on Monday morning. So there will be someone there round the clock to protect our interests. Okay, so basically there'll be some poly up there to protect the inside of those rooms from the elements, but they pretty much will be accessible if someone wanted to get in there. Therefore, we will have security on campus. Then Monday morning, the demolition of the link wing will start at the middle school. And if some of you don't know where the link is, it's the connector between the 1930s building and the gym, and that will be basically gutted out. And we are asking once again that citizens stay off the middle school grounds during the April vacation break. Teachers have been asked to stay off until Sunday, April 23rd. When school opens on the 24th, we will have access to the new Pond Cove gym, which at this point is finished. I've been able to peek in. We can't walk on the floor yet, but the lines are down, and it looks wonderful. And we will have access to the new cafetorium. All elementary students will start to eat in the cafetorium with bag lunches as of April 24th. The kitchens are not anticipated to be ready and opened until about May 15th. And when they open, we'll move the middle school lunches to the new cafeteria. But for the time being, for the next couple of weeks anyway, just the Pond Cove students will be eating in there. And they will be eating by the same satellite lunch means that they've been eating with in their classrooms. And fourth grade parents are getting a letter. It may have come today. Some will arrive tomorrow, sort of explaining the process for what's going to happen on Friday and then what will happen after the vacation break. Do you have any questions?
Carla? It's not strictly a construction question, but I thought of it when you were talking about the floors that they're preparing for the new wing for the fourth grade. And also, since we've been talking so much about upkeep, I was in a first grade, one of the new first grade classrooms recently, and the floor was unbelievably filthy, and it really looked like ground and dirt, not just the day's dirt. And are we having time in all of this to get back and wash those floors, or?
One of the reasons our own staff is doing the classrooms now for the move is because the classroom floors were not properly cleaned prior to our moving in. They didn't, actually, they partially cleaned them. People were still working on the floors. So they never got down to stripping them with clean water and what you need to strip them. They sort of waxed over dirt. That was one of the problems. That's certainly not all of the problem. A lot of the problem is that there's been a lot of mud on the playground, and it's been tracked in. And right now, I hope you noticed that we have redone those hallways. The hallways look very nice.
All look nice.
But the classrooms have not been redone. They are going to be done over April vacation. And then with a conscientious effort by staff and the students themselves, we are going to try to keep them clean. They also won't be eating in the classrooms as of April 24th either. But what you're saying is absolutely true. I mean, I've seen them, and it's very frustrating to walk through and say, brand new building, and you know, it looks so dirty. The other thing that we've done is we have rescheduled our staff with the move, too. We feel that the custodian that has been taking care of Building C has had more than he could handle. So we have also brought on another person so that we'll have two over at Pond Cove, and I think that we have put two together that will work well together and assist one another in keeping that place looking in tip-top shape. So what you say is absolutely true, but we know that we are working on it, and I have observed the same thing.
Anybody else? Charlie?
Just a question on security of the general facility. Probably a couple weeks ago on a Sunday, I just stopped by, and I don't find it to be very secure. You could walk into the area that they are demilitarizing, or whatever you want to call it, because it looks like a war zone. And you could walk right in. And
we're concerned, too. In fact, I was concerned because I went up over the weekend and did exactly as you did. You could go any place you wanted to, and there really weren't any deterrents for your getting there. And you didn't even have to try very hard. So I spoke to Peter from D.L. Poulin, and I spoke to Jim Gilman. And I said, is this pretty much how it is in other places in construction projects? I mean, are things this accessible and open? I said, I am concerned because we have two gates, but neither one of the gates are closed. I said, so, you know, anyone who really wants to walk through the site can. And it concerned me also. So he said, yeah. Jim said, I'm going to talk to Peter. We need to do better with it. But this isn't all that unusual. Our insurance carrier came down too, and we have a letter that I just got, a report that he had given to Scott for us to distribute to the contractor that says we need more signage that says keep out, danger, construction workers only, and they will be getting a copy of that letter tomorrow. So it's part of our construction meeting minutes because I brought it up at the last meeting, and now I have the letter that specifically states exactly what they need to do. I did notice tonight, though, I went up there to check out the new cafetorium. They started to put the ceramic tile down in that foyer way, and everything was locked up because I couldn't get in. So that was sort of a good sign that as things start to finish up, they are locking the spaces and keeping people out. And that's the first time that I haven't had, you know, 100% access to any place I wanted to go. So
I was really concerned about the where the new media center is going to be in the middle school, I mean the elementary school, because it's the end, you could just walk right in, and that's you know, just especially with children, that's a with a playground in close proximity and no one around to guard or monitor anything. So I was glad to hear that they're going to put on some kind of security. Hopefully he'll...
And that was our request. That was an owner request. They actually didn't volunteer to do it, but when I was rather concerned about it, they agreed that probably that would be a good idea and that they would do that. I said, you can't leave it open from Saturday to Monday. I said, especially if, you know, Easter Sunday people are out walking, it's a nice day, you'll have people all over this place.
And, so, and that was one of the things that, you know, that we guaranteed both the zoning and the planning board that things would be secure, you know, because we would be using the part of the facilities, and it hasn't been the case.
Probably it wouldn't be a bad idea for us to write a letter to the contractor expressing our concerns so that there will be some written documentation that we actually have addressed this issue, and it has come from the board to me. And perhaps we need to also involve our own police department to do more frequent checks of the facility as well. So I think those are two things that we might do to, you know, as it gets warmer and stays lighter later, we're going to have more difficulties too. So I agree with you.
Good idea.
Anybody else? Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Going on, the next item in the packet is the report card for 93-94, which somehow I always feel these things are anticlimactic. They tell us what was happening 2 years ago. For instance, you'll notice in the economic indicators, it doesn't look like we have any debt service, which is really out of date. So,
and that Jock McKernan is still the governor.
Yes.
Yeah.
That had escaped me.
Really?
Oh, yes. Well, it was written fall of 94. That was, I guess, before the election. So I do, in fact, include it for your commentary. We distribute that in the normal way, but I don't have anything remarkable to say. So unless you have a comment, I'll keep on going.
Comments?
Okay. Next item under my report is a senior service project update, and I did include some material. I think it was 2 months ago that David Perry came to our meeting, and gave you an update about what the senior service project is for this year, and commented that this is the third year of a pilot, and we agreed to sit down and talk. So I had a meeting with David and Gail Schmader, who have been two of the principals involved for all 3 years. As I noted in your agenda notes, they really want some direction from the board. And they included in the material on principles of good practice for combining service and learning. They added some common threads in the discussions they've had, some of which David went over with you at the previous meeting. And also gave you a sense of what some area high schools similar to Cape Elizabeth are doing, Yarmouth, Falmouth, Cumberland, North Yarmouth, or Greeley, Gorham, and Scarborough. Schools similar in composition, aspirations, and so forth, so you have an idea of what that is. I don't see any huge similarity, but one of the things that I would say is that it indicates an interest in all of those schools, some more formalized than others. I thought it was interesting that the schools that had some graduation requirement basically spread it out over 4 years. In other words, it was somewhat like saying that somewhere in those four years you need to pay attention to this as a requirement, but not squish it into the last few weeks of the senior year. I think one of the one of the issues for the board to give the staff some, and for that matter myself, some direction is how important do you think this is in, to us as a, on a policy level? Do you like the idea of a requirement? And if so, should it be a requirement that's focused on a given year, or should it be something of a more general nature as it is there? Is it, should it be credit bearing? Do activities like that, obviously, if it's going to be something with some substance to it, it's going to require staffing. Mm-hmm. We've had very generous contributions from the staff members who've been involved with that, but we certainly cannot continue to ask that level of commitment. There are volunteers involved. I know some of you have served on as advisors, but for a structure to exist, there has to be some kind of accountability, responsibility, and no doubt some compensation. So those are some of the issues, and the only other school that we've talked about with a model on this one is Chevers, which has that last month of the year. I think it's the last month, maybe it's, is it more than a month?
Mm-mm.
About a month, where the entire senior class is required to go out, but that one has never quite worked in our school setting, and I don't see it listed on their sheet to be considered, but that, of course, is also a private school, which may have some of the, make some of the differences. So anyway, we would like to get some direction from you, and hopefully you've had a chance to think about it.
Well, I'll just make a comment. I guess reading over what all the other schools do, there were lots of pieces of each of them that I liked. I've always felt that we need to have our kids start giving back to the community from a very young age, and we actually do a lot of that in the elementary schools. We hear about fourth grade working with first and second graders this week to read to them and those kind of things. So part of me likes the idea of spreading it out over the high school, but also part of me sort of likes Gorham's model that does the one full week, 99% of the seniors participate, and it's the focus is on giving back to your own community. So I guess I would be open to a lot of options, and I almost feel like we really need to form that ad hoc committee and sit down and really study this. But my direction would be to definitely continue to look into it, and but it has to be sort of focused in what we can do. And I guess I'm concerned about how few students are participating in the current senior service project, and I don't even know how many are actually participating right now. I know that a lot have been dropping out. And what are the reasons for that? And then we need a model that works for our community.
I think there are a couple of variables involved. First of all, the availability of services for the kids over that 2 or 3 week span. You know, we're in a location where the availability of volunteers in various areas are more than a walk away or a close drive. I think the other consideration, this was the first year in which the faculty elected to remove the high school students from having to be responsible for work that had, I mean, up until this year, students were required to do makeup work for that. This was the first year that the faculty as a group said that the students would be exempt from that during that 2 or 3 week period that they were working in senior service projects. So I think there are a couple of variables here. One is, I think maybe perhaps more seniors would have been involved if they knew that earlier on. Also the fact of and Gail Schmader has been tremendously helpful in helping with this as well as Janet McLaughlin. But as Connie mentioned, we need in-house staff to help with the preparation, selection, and it entails quite a bit of work, but I firmly support an ad hoc committee, which I would love to be a part of, as we look at something that would fit Cape Elizabeth's needs, not necessarily Gorham's or Scarborough's,
but pieces of all of these.
There are some very, very valuable pieces here that we need to look at. So I think we have 23 seniors, I believe, in this year's.
I think it's a lot less since I'm an advisor.
Okay, maybe it's down to 18, or I think there were initially the applicants were there about 23 to 25. But also we have ongoing volunteers who are working with through the Big Buddy program that really don't count toward a senior service project, but yet are devoting their time to the kids, also working with the elementary students too, with the kindergarten students. So we need to be able to collectively grasp all that information together and give students credit for that, that sort of service also.
Charlie?
I would kind of agree with Beth. There were things that I liked out of all of it. I really liked it being, I think it's hard to manage a short period of time with a large number of students and to find areas for them to do service, you know, because of our proximity, we don't have public transportation. There are obstacles, even though we have a very mobile population of students. So I really was kind of interested in some kind of obligation over a four-year period, and that's why I liked about Yarmouth. There was a contract, there's a commitment. I liked Gorham, where 99% of the student body, I would see it as a graduation requirement. I think we need to look at what we have in place, because I know some of the classes do some service projects. And the other thing I liked about Yarmouth is we have this problem with students not being able to fill up time slots, and maybe this is where we could use that, and Yarmouth allows them to leave study halls to work on service projects. And I kind of like Beth's approach to using our own community. There are many, many things that they could do within this community.
We pay our students to work in the community services programs with our youth programs like soccer and basketball in communities like Yarmouth and Falmouth. That's where the students pick up their time volunteering. So rather than being paid for that service, working with the youth of the community, that's their service to the communities to go back and work with the younger kids in the program. That's something we need to revisit also. Our students are used to receiving that, doing it for pay, and maybe it's time for them to think about giving back some of the things to the community from what they've gained. So I think, again, that's something else to look at. And that would open up a lot of avenues for kids to utilize that time.
I would imagine that the two-week block would be very difficult for other Maine Medical or any other facility that would be having our children or young people to prepare them and teach them what to do, and then they're there 5 days
and then go,
out the door. And something long-term that would be more beneficial to those serving. And
it's a quick investment, and you're right.
You're asking a lot, really, for them to do. I'd like to see what when they say back service to the community, you did refer to that with the sports program, but it would be interesting to see exactly what 99% of their class is actually doing.
Mm-hmm.
Because that we have a lot of children that would need a lot of places.
But I think spreading it out over 4 years really gives students an opportunity to choose and pick their spots, and it's something of interest that they have, be it at a hospital setting or a nursing home.
Well, I like that better than all together at the end of the senior year, which is already so hectic, and they're out of here anyway in their heads.
So.
It seems to me that we need to even step back from this discussion, though, and talk at the board level about what we see service as being, and does it start at ninth grade, or is there, a certain culture we want to have starting in kindergarten? So I think there's some data collection that could go on now, first of all, about what's going on in the schools right now. As you said, there's the Big Buddy program and all those kinds of things, various opportunities that are out there, and what's good and what's bad about what we're doing now. But at the same time, I think the board really needs to step back from, the practical program right now and talk about that and raise that with the community as well, as far as what they'd like to see, and then build the program from there, because I don't think we've had a discussion about what a service curriculum would really look like, or what we even mean by that. Whether that means giving back to our school, to our town, to anybody, So I think maybe we have to start at the policy committee level even, and, try to formulate, a board view on that and see how the community, feels about that, and then build a program off of a philosophy.
Well, I think that's the point that David and Gail and I talked about, that with absent a philosophy, it's hard for people within the system to know exactly what to craft. We could craft a variety of things depending on the emphasis that the board wishes to place on this. One of the things that I thought was interesting, and Gail pointed out in this handout in your packet, that service learning is something that, she said, the trouble with the term community service, unfortunately, it is sometimes used as, you know, what the in lieu of serving time in jail, you know, you do community service, and there is a certain amount of connotation there that may be less than positive. So she was trying to emphasize that whole idea of what do you learn by service. I think, for instance, maybe the policy committee is a very good place to start, that there could be, and certainly there are extant policies that you can look to for some guidance on that. If, in fact, it is a part of the philosophy of the Cape Elizabeth School Board that service, learning through giving service, some statement or a series of statements about that, is part of a well-rounded educational opportunity, then it flows from that there would be either administrative policies or programs or various statements about supporting what that would mean. If, in fact, the board were to choose, on just in contrast, a philosophy that says that doesn't belong as part of a well-rounded education, clearly other decisions flow from that. So we could start at the policy level, keeping in mind that we have an ad hoc committee as a result, probably, or the policy committee could decide, is this time to, yes, go with that or so forth. But I do think, I agree, I think it really is important, and I think it's important to the staff to get board direction on this. How much time do you want us to give to it? How much do you think that this community wants to incorporate it as part of the educational system? I personally think that it would be very good for kids. We read a lot today about concern about national values, character education in one way or the other. We're not, I personally would not want to see schools turned into an academy where we're supposed to teach a curriculum of values. I think that's a very tough issue, and I don't know that I certainly wouldn't want to make that decision. On the other hand, learning through service is not teaching a whole set of discrete values. It's not getting into things that probably families are better off dealing with, or those kinds of conversations we get into. We are a democracy, and service is part of being a citizen. And therefore, I think that we're on very sound ground when we do that, but we need some narrowing of the ground as to what you actually want to support and some practicalities of how much time and resources will go into this, that kind of thing.
And the experiences that students have come back with have been wonderful. I mean, the kids just come back and say, "What?" And I would like to spread that down so it may trigger some interest in students at the younger age, you know, as a sophomore and junior, to be involved in an activity and find that may be a direction that they want to seek beyond high school into a college arena. So I think leaving it up to that last 2 or 3 weeks of the senior year doesn't allow a student to really reflect on his or her experience and say, is this an area of interest that I may want to pursue as a, you know, professionally? And I think if we allow students that opportunity to pick their time, it may trigger some valuable insight for the students. So.
The other thing I might do is help with that problem again about scheduling. And if we're going to be trying to keep kids from cramming everything in for the first 2.5 years or so, you know, they complain about the stress level as much as anybody else. That gives you a kind of a way to step back, to still be doing something very constructive and positive, but it's not directly in the classroom. But, you know, make it part of the curriculum.
Well, just one other added, the members of the sophomore class have been volunteering time in the soup kitchens all through the school year, and that hasn't been mentioned as a service, but they've been doing that all year, volunteering their times and weekends and
right.
Sundays.
Right.
And that was something that the class advisors pursued as they felt interested. And perhaps that's something that a class advisor or would also be part of this discussion in an ad hoc committee, because it does generate a wide variety of experiences for the kids.
So that's what I saw as stretching it out, is better utilization of resources than trying to find release time for teachers and to find volunteers from the community to help them in a 3-week project.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so.
Now, if David was listening to this, maybe he is. He's probably saying, you guys left it hanging again.
No.
No, but we had said we were going to form some committee when David presented to us, or some roundtable discussion.
Right. But I mean, I think we have to set a time where we talk about it from the policy level and decide what information we need to gather and go from there. So can we do it at the next policy meeting?
We have our agenda on the back page of this.
The only thing I'm worried about is we promised Sue Weatherby we'd go through all the community service fee things at the next policy committee meeting, which might be lengthy or it might go quickly. That would be my only concern, is because we also put a timeline on that we would get back with a the new guidelines. She needs those to enact them.
By July 1st.
For July 1st, so they have to be adopted at the June board meeting. But I'm happy to do the senior service project also. I'm just not sure of how much time each will take.
How about instead of having that on the actual agenda, we just take the time to make a list of the kind of information we know we're going to want before school is out, so we can get that, and maybe we can start addressing it at the policy level at the May meeting.
Yep, that sounds good.
But that way we could maybe have the data by then.
And only have David or Gail come to the May meeting? Or would they not come?
To the May meeting?
The May policy meeting?
I think we need to have a discussion first among board members just about, you know, about what direction we kind of want to go, and then open it up from there. I think it's going to be a, you know, a kind of process of, you know, first we discuss it, and then we open it up to that group, and, you know, then we open it up to the students and the community to, you know, take a look at it. But I mean, we just have not, as a board, everybody nods and says, you know, this is wonderful. And,
yeah.
But who knows if we're, you know, we're all on the same wavelength, and until we have some.
Yeah, I think we can easily do that at the next policy committee meeting. And I would ask every board member here to jot down their ideas so that it's not just the members present at the policy meeting that come up with something that we've missed, something that other board members are very interested in. And then we can proceed with that. And at the May board meeting, you know, broaden it even more with Gail and David Perry or whoever. And then maybe then after that step is completed, then form the ad hoc community group, you know, and broader representation.
We can do that.
Does that make sense to everybody?
Okay.
So on your April 25th meeting, you're going to be talking about community services fee schedules.
That will be the major piece that we need to get done there at that meeting, so we can bring something back to this group in May and hopefully passed in June. But we will then do we will discuss this also.
So you want to hear from all of us by April 25th?
Write notes. Call Gail, because I'll be away. Gail will take your notes. And that would be great, just to give us some direction of what you're thinking, and so that we collect the right data or find out the right things before school is over.
Okay. Thank you. That's a good one to move ahead on.
Yes.
I'm glad they've been keeping at us.
Yes. All right. I'm not going to go on. I could go on for about an hour on this last item, and I do have absolutely no intention of doing that. You may notice I have a little pin on that says keeping promises. We mentioned, I think, at the last board meeting, or perhaps it was during the budget process, that the town council here at CAPE has contributed to a group called Citizens or Coalition for Equitable School Funding. We've had some conversations about that. I've distributed some materials to you. What is happening right now, today, Jane Amaral presented a bill that was essentially framing a change in the funding formula. It's referenced in the paper today. There's a lead editorial supporting it. This area of the state does, generally speaking, support it. What is at issue here, again, perhaps for the public, is the funding formula that we operate under, which determines local and state share of specified school costs. Cape Elizabeth does, in fact, receive subsidy. We frequently are called a wealthy town in the paper, and sometimes I'm tempted to think with a little bit of touch of reverse discrimination. However, in fact, we don't receive anywhere near as much subsidy in percentage basis as poorer towns do. So that's what equalized formulas are supposed to do. They're supposed to give you something, but not as much as somebody who has greater need. The fact that we get formula at all indicates that we do have a need and that it is fair to include us in these discussions. We do not have any notable business property. We have some, of course, but it is certainly nothing like South Portland or Falmouth or any of our neighbors on the Route 1 strip. But we, in this part of the, again, the southern part of the state, we do in fact share some common problems. Our property values were greatly accelerated in the 80s. People's income didn't necessarily change, but the taxes certainly did. And one of the discussions that has been going on through five different task force attempts to adjust the funding, school funding formula, has been to include income. And the bill that Jane Emerow has presented does just that, with some additional factors such as cost of living, and also looking at, for instance, what the tax actually is on a median value property, particularly private property, house property, in given communities. I think you've seen some of that information that's been in the paper. The Rosser Commission report has sparked a lot of discussion about this. I should also share with you, and I did share with you a printout, this is a very troubling situation because there simply isn't enough money to fund the 285 administrative districts that happen to be in this state at the same kind of level. And when you adjust a formula, it's pretty predictable that some people who have been getting more may get a little less, and other people who have been getting less may get a little more, and that's what's happening. And naturally, every time this happens, districts or areas of the state tend to argue about what's fair. I've been spending some time listening to the debates and also participating in them, and one of the schemes that has been floated is one that would take $500,000 out of the budget you just adopted. That's certainly something we cannot afford and would be, in my opinion, the height of being unfair, and have expressed myself to that degree. I'm not at all sure that that particular scheme is going to be voted in, but you need to be aware that it's a possibility, which is why I'm at least spending some time watching the process, testifying for Jane's bill or Senator Amaro's bill. We don't have to be quite that informal, I guess. I don't really want to be a prophet of doom, nor do I wish to be unduly alarmist. It would seem to me that we will probably come up with some kind of compromise if they can't pass a bill. But what's at stake here is the education, first the education subcommittee coming up with a recommendation. They're supposedly going to do it by the 15th, which is Saturday. I think they're a long way off from doing that. The method of distribution of formula, which is actually existing law, is the amount that we use to build our budget on. In fact, we didn't take the full amount because we felt that it was unclear to us what the disposition would be, and we knew that that so-called percentage reduction formula does in fact take some money away from some communities. It's been a problem for the last two or three years, actually the last 4 years, that the state has not had enough money to fund the school budget at the full amount. So there is this inevitable push-pull, and I can't tell you what will happen. But the process has started today with a bill that does add the income as a factor. It would change some of the variables. It is certainly important that we keep a perspective on this. We don't really want to get into some kind of north-south civil war. People were walking around the State House with some of these buttons, and then there were other buttons that said the county, and I leave it up to you to decide which county was being represented by that particular button. But we were still able to have civil discourses in the corridor, so we're not truly erupting yet. I don't have anything specific to report to you except that that's an ongoing process. I'd be happy to answer questions, and I do intend to try to summarize this for the council tomorrow so that they understand, as we present our budget to them, that we are dealing with a number of uncertainties there's a scenario there that could put us under intense pressure. I hope that that scenario is not the likely one, but it is out there. Now that I've depressed you all, I keep on going.
Okay. We just have to stay tuned, right?
Stay tuned.
Thank you for your hard work up there. It's very helpful.
Well, it's actually interesting. It's just kind of time consuming, and it's hard to know if you're doing any good. But
wow.
I think one of the things that is happening, a number of people in the areas that are typically described as being low receivers have come together, and one of the problems is that we don't wish to be unduly grabbing, or I mean it's very hard to. I look at a printout. Cape Elizabeth appears in the printout between Callis and Caribou. Neither one of them written up ever in the paper as a wealthy community. And when a particular funding formula takes money away from both Callis and Caribou and gives it to Cape Elizabeth, or at least that's the way it appears because one follows the other, I want to be very certain this is, in fact, a fair distribution. And I have investigated it. I think that both of those communities ought to qualify for some kind of hardship issues, but I think that the formula that we're talking about is a fairer way of going at this across the state than the one that we are currently operating under. So I've given that a lot of thought from an ethical point of view, and I'm satisfied that that is the direction we should be going in. The bill that was introduced today, but also the Rosser Commission, stresses the importance of funding the circuit breaker for property owners. Because whether you live in Cape Elizabeth or Callis or Caribou, there are property owners who are under extreme pressure. And that circuit breaker, which refunds at a certain percentage for income and so on, is a really enlightened way of helping people who are facing, wherever they happen to live, an undue share of the tax burden. And there's been a good deal of support for that. Again, these things are all competing for the same dollars. And you don't have to do anything more than pick up the paper to see there are all kinds of other worthy programs competing for the same dollars. But those would be the issues that I would urge this community to be aware of and to support. A restructuring of the funding formula, a support for the circuit breaker on property tax, and a recognition that there will be some changes. I also want to tell you I've talked a lot with people about school construction because one of the interesting, and certainly this community is well aware of this, if you look at the number of school construction projects that have been awarded in the last 15 years, which I have done, about 3 to 1 are in the so-called high receiver districts. There hasn't been a lot granted to low receiver districts. There's been some, but not a lot. And that's not really a factor that's listed on the construction lists, but it seems to be a pattern. And that the Rosser Commission, however, makes some very specific recommendations about dealing with school construction. We're not the only community facing a lot of problems, and we were at least able to address ours. There are many communities. Our neighbor South Portland is one of them that is facing even more extensive problems it's just a very serious problem that the state's got to come to grips with.
And actually, if you look at the millions that Portland spent in the last 10 years in school construction, then none of it was state funded.
That's right. South Portland, Westbrook, and Falmouth and Cape Elizabeth are all communities that have shared construction problems. We are fortunate in that our problems were smaller in the sense that we only had 2 buildings that we were dealing with rather than 6 or 7. And we have barely squeaked through, I think, an opportunity to bring them up before they totally fell apart. But it's a pretty much a widespread problem. So we'll see what happens. Okay, that's it.
All right, moving on to school board subcommittees and reports. Finance Subcommittee, Charlie?
The Finance Subcommittee met at 6:30 this evening. We signed the warrants, reviewed the school lunch state printouts, looked at certain appropriation accounts, salaries and benefits, electricity costs, and building project expenses from our general operating fund. We reviewed a request from the middle school concerning the purchase of computers, and it was tabled to the Technology Steering Committee, which will meet tomorrow. And other business, we looked at FTE positions that come about above and beyond the budget process, and also looking at trips and conferences in reference to those type of things, and feeling that those should be discussed first at the Finance Subcommittee as far as cost impact, budget impact, before they go on to the board for approval. So we were looking at that for long term for next year.
Okay. All right, moving on to School Building Committee, Charlie.
The School Building Committee met on March 23rd. We essentially reviewed the project at that point as far as what was going on. Sue gave you some time frame of what is involved in moving into those parts that have been rehabbed. We essentially moved on four change order items, and we will meet again on April 27th.
Hey, Policy Subcommittee, Beth?
I forgot the exact date that we met, but I think it was March 29th or March 30th. It was a Wednesday. And we spent the majority of our time discussing the administrative guideline on placement policies at Pond Cove and the field trip policies. We still have work to do, but we do have some work done, and we will spend our next meeting, which is on a Tuesday. It is Tuesday, April 25th at 9:15, looking at the recommendations from the Community Services Fee Committee, and we will look at the Senior Service Project, and we still need to work on athletic field trip guidelines.
All right, moving on to Athletic Fee Committee. Charlie, is that you? Again.
I thought the superintendent was going to comment on that. So I wasn't even prepared.
All right, I'll take it. I included in your packet the memorandum because actually the process for these committees, that is the athletic and the co-curricular fee committees, is to meet in the spring and to discuss any issues that come up either because of changes in conditions or requests from the people involved, et cetera, and then to come to the board with recommendations. So attached to the memo was the chart for athletic fees as they currently exist and a rather dated summary of the report from an original athletic fee committee setting in place some of the factors, but they must have done a good job because, frankly, most of that is still in place and works reasonably well. So just to bring everybody, including new board members, up to speed, that was included to give you an idea. In essence, we reviewed the several requests and support the request, two requests from the middle school asking for additional coaches that were in fact included to be on the safe side. The money for these was included in the budget that you just adopted, but they hadn't had, this is the opportunity they have to actually formally request and explain why they need that. In both cases, it has to deal with one specific position for sixth graders, additional cross-country coach. Sixth grade is the first opportunity youngsters have in our circuit to participate. They cannot participate in all interscholastic sports, but they do participate in a couple, and cross country, I guess, is kind of the major one.
Actually, indoor track.
Mm. Oh, indoor.
Cross country and spring track, they run with a pack that they don't count.
Okay.
So
But at any rate, a lot of youngsters do go out. I mean, this is, you know, if you've got somebody at that age level or have had, the first time that you're able to put on a uniform and represent the school seems to have a magic moment. And we do get a lot of kids coming out, and we have an excellent, in cross country, we have an excellent coach who has also inspired a lot of kids in Joe Doan. I remember when he was a running winner for, I think he went to Chevers, if I remember correctly. Anyway, I know he was an excellent runner himself. At any rate, supervision is a problem, and I do remember talking to Mr. Sanborn, who is one of our crossing guards, about his concerns about kids running out in the afternoon, crossing the road and so forth, and so I know that there really is a need. We didn't have much trouble supporting that request. Again, the second middle school request was a supervisory or monitoring position for middle school indoor track, which has to practice down at the high school and certainly has required extra supervision. There is some thought that that may in fact be met in the middle school itself next year, and if so, and we don't need the supervisory monitor position, fine, but we thought it was prudent to have both of those in the budget. The rest of this report have to do with Keith Weatherby brought up the whole issue of a ninth grade coach for girls soccer next fall. It's been kind of a perennial issue. Sometimes there has been a provision for interscholastic play for ninth grade girls on soccer, and sometimes there hasn't. He anticipates as many as 60 to 70 girls may come out for soccer due to the increased enrollment at the high school next year. And he said that although he had not put money specifically tagged as a ninth grade girls coach, he knew that he would be able to have some monies available from a couple of changes since he had put his budget together, and that if this is approved, he would be able to manage it within the current budget, that is the budget you just adopted. And we do, the Athletic Fee Committee supports this request, provided that no new money be added to the budget. The rest of the meeting was spent in discussions that did not come up with specific suggestions per se, although Charlie Greer asked about what triggers a review of current positions in sports that do not continue to attract sufficient numbers to fully support the activity. We had some discussion of very small teams that still, in fact, seem to be serving a very legitimate purpose. Golf was mentioned, not a big number of youngsters going out for it, but important for those who do. And we finally agreed that fewer than 15 participants would trigger an annual review. And Belinda Snell, who is this year's affirmative action officer and as such attends these meetings, said she'd been asked about the status of girls lacrosse. Keith Weatherby explained the usual practice of asking parents to support a club activity to prove enough interest before going to the school board for any further support. He also said that girls would be allowed to play on the existing boys team if they so desired. I don't think he mentioned, Charlie, do you remember, did he? Anybody
there was one
ever
girl, I believe. One girl. One?
Okay. So at this point, we're not making any requests in that respect.
What really triggered the discussion about when do you review participation, the winter track season for boys in particular had a very small turnout, and that was what triggered mine. And we were supporting two coaches to support a very small percentage of people, and they had no mechanism for review. So.
Concerning women's lacrosse, we also we have eight young girls now who are playing on the combined team with members of Macaulay and other schools of Walton called Back Bay Club. And it is a club basis. So we have about eight girls this year who are transported by parents into Portland to play for a club in there. So we, as Connie alluded to, we do not have a team or a club at this point, but we do have eight students who are participating
formal
club league in Portland.
Thank you. And Keith?
In terms of the ninth grade girls soccer, do we have a field Is there field time available for another team to practice?
My understanding was that they actually do play pretty much in the same area. They don't need a separate field for practices anyway.
Correct. They would utilize the space that's currently existing. And Keith, that was not an issue. Keith, as baseball is an issue, soccer seems to be not an issue as far as space is concerned. The teams can't combine a freshman and JV team practicing in the same facility, same field with space issues there.
And the issue of scheduling games has to be addressed too.
There has been a problem in the past with enough ninth grade, with other schools that had enough ninth grade participation, and evidently the interest in soccer and with the incoming ninth grade, not in just our school, but in other schools, that they would form some kind of a game season. We also got to the discussion as the high school population grows, that you may have to get to the point where you have to set, you know, a limit on the number of children that can participate. And we, to some degree, have not been forced with that option. It started a little bit with some of the sports, but we've never really been forced, and we're going to be forced with that. And you think that we may have, you know, as much as 200 students more than we've had, you know, 3 years ago.
That's true. I mean,
so we may not be able to create teams because we have increased, you know, there are going to have to be other options for children. Students, pardon me.
Okay. Anybody else?
Okay. It was an interesting process of the first time. On 6 years on the board, I've never been to an athletic fee committee or a co-curricular.
Maybe
and as you see, the co-curricular did not come with a report because
no, that one that definitely will take longer. If you want to take a motion on accepting this report, even though it's not under business, you could take a motion now.
All right. Yeah.
I'll make a motion that we accept the report from the athletic fee committee as presented.
Second. Any discussion? All in favor? 7-0.
Thank you.
Okay, the next item is Principal Search Committee. Bonnie,
and I'll just make a few general comments moving along. We've had our first meeting, and we have, I think, an excellent committee. We also have sent out feedback sheets to all the staff at the building level, and had some discussion among staff as to how we could reach out to parents, and I discovered that we were sending out a mailing, and so we included a sheet for parents, and I really thank anybody who may be listening to this who has already sent that feedback sheet back. Even though the date that was on there for it to be returned, if you haven't turned it back and you have some interest, please do so, because thanks to a couple of the committee members, we were sort of collating them, and they're really very interesting, and they're kind of all over the ballpark. Not quite sure what we can find to meet all those expectations. But it's all helpful, and it's part of the process, and we really appreciate people's input. We're moving along on that.
Okay. Next item is unfinished business policies for second reading. Beth?
I think it's third reading. It's just the first aid policy, EBBA-R. The changes on it were at the bottom of the page. The one and two were sort of combined and broadened. And I think it was taking the direction from this group and what they wanted.
Any comments on this, or can we finally move on this?
Then I'd like to make a motion that we accept policy EBBA-R.
I second that.
Any discussion?
Don't worry. Just that there's a typo on the back page. Oh, circumstance.
Oh my gosh.
Extreme circumstance.
Yeah.
That's all. Don't panic.
I have that. Okay. All right.
All in favor? 7-0. Sure the nurses will be glad.
I think so.
That was the only one, though.
Well, yeah, I'm not sure. The Pond Cove placement procedure, would that be, that, I think that's a first reading. We, this is the first time we're bringing it, but it's under a separate spot. Connie, were you thinking on speaking to it?
I thought it was important enough to kind of highlight, although I'm not sure why I put it that way, perfectly honest with you. The, you adopted a policy, I think, if I remember correctly, it was actually 2 years ago, and you had administrative procedures without a great deal of discussion from high school, which has been amended at least once since then, and middle school. Last year, we spent a great deal of time looking at the administrative procedure for placement at Pond Cove and came up with a process that had not actually been written down. I mean, it had been written down in various ways, but not as a finished process. So that was a piece we had to do this year, and this is, I think, a good summary of that. In addition, I did include in your packet a letter which I had received from a parent who wanted you to reconsider some aspects of this, and I understand from Wayne that he'd had some conversation with that parent to try to clarify some of the issues there, and I did do an update on the placement policy change as a kind of explanation. I included that for you today, but you haven't really had a chance to read this. So what I would really like is some feedback from you as to how good a summary, especially those of you who are involved, how good a summary of our discussions do you find this? And secondly, for those of you who weren't involved in the discussion, I would like to know from you if that is, you know, you think it's clear. I mean, it's always, it's, as a teacher, I know when you ask people, do you have any questions? Well, if you haven't had any experience with this, I don't know if the impression you're getting is accurate or not, but I'd be happy to answer any questions. Furthermore, especially if you are involved with students at Pond Cove, I'm not sure whether you want or think it advisable to send this memorandum out or to distribute it among staff or what. So I apologize for not getting it to you sooner, but it is in your packet and it's intended to be used in a variety of ways, and give me some feedback when you have a chance.
I think it should go out to parents. That letter confused me.
Which letter?
From the letter that was in our communication.
From the parent.
From the parent. I mean, I couldn't find where the relevance. The only thing I could see that the parent felt that they were outside the loop, that they no longer had first control. And that's the impression I got from that letter.
Well, I think there is a lot of confusion still, and we just are still working on the process to make it the norm.
But I think maybe this type of letter would clarify why we're approaching it from a different aspect.
I think, too, that part of it is the wording of the questionnaire that goes home to parents. I think it needs to be more explicit that we're asking for your input so the teacher can use that input in creating a balanced classroom. Because it looks, the way it works now, it looks like you're asking for the feedback and then it goes into a black hole, which it doesn't. The teacher uses it to make a balanced classroom, but not to pick a particular teacher.
And I think this update clarifies it.
Well, I haven't had a chance to read it, but I'm sure it does.
I just read it.
Well, except the input, actually, I state here, and from my understanding of it, is really primarily intended to go to the receiving teacher. So read that carefully and see if you think it is, because I mean this is critical. When you make a change such as we made in that procedure last year, it takes 2 or 3 years, number one, to gradually adjust what we're actually doing, number two, to make sure that people understand the purposes behind it. If it isn't serving the purpose, clearly we have to make some other kinds of adjustments, but that's my best shot at it right now. So before we do anything with this, I'd like your feedback. So
I think the other thing that's missing is that parents have not really gotten any feedback about how the system worked this past year. Mm-hmm. Anyway, you know, how teachers felt about it, which, you know, I would be running into teachers in the grocery store who were telling me how great it was, that it worked, that their classrooms were better, and things like that. And I'm not sure there was ever really any official, you know, awareness of, you know, how did we think it worked? So that might be helpful too, because sure. I think people kind of forget about the issue from last placement time to this placement time, and might be good just to wrap it up. Carla?
The area where I still think there might continue to be confusion, though, is the first thing I was going to say is what Connie just said, that a lot of the parental input is meant for the receiving teacher. But then that still leaves a confusion, such as was in that letter, and that's not really clarified here. There are actually a few cases where the parental input is used for the grouping, like most specifically if there's a valid negative peer type of thing.
Right.
That's really not intended for that's taken care of ahead of time. Mm-hmm. So there is still that little piece of confusion. Right.
I don't think I included in that, and that may be something that Wayne and I can talk about. But again, this is an attempt to summarize what was an enormously complex set of discussions, and I wouldn't hurt my feelings at all for you to make some constructive comments, but I did think from various discussions we had that we probably need to either send out a letter, make it available, some process that makes sense to you and to the teachers and so forth, just let me know.
And I agree with Ann. If there was success with the process this past year in the placement of children and the functioning of classrooms, I think that should be communicated back to parents. It's just communication. And
Yeah. Okay. So that will, you'll get back to me, right?
Right.
Do you want to look at this policy now? The administrative guideline, or?
So this is technically a first reading, though, right?
Yes, it is an administrative guideline, though. It is not,
right.
You know, the full policy was 2 years ago, and we didn't do that for a review at this point.
Well, I guess we do need feedback from the other board members about this.
Yeah.
Of course, looking at it now, it's hard to tell what the changes were that were made.
Yeah.
But I think, wasn't it just, what didn't we?
The changes were, it's really the change from the old policy, which had teachers placing children in specific teachers' classrooms. I mean, it's a real drastic change. This is actually what happened last year. And this is then the writing up and the fine tuning of it. If that makes it any clearer. The old policy was, or the old administrative guideline was nothing like what we did last year. So it's a drastic change. And I guess what the revisions we did on this at the last meeting and discussing at the meeting before, we're trying to, in a general way, write down what did happen last year and the best parts of it and what we wanted to be sure was consistently applied in the future, if that gives any basis to the discussion here.
I think what would be helpful if, for those of us who don't have kindergarten children, to see the letter that goes home to parents. And that it says see attached. Well, it didn't.
Well, the attached was actually the appeal process.
Okay. I would like to see both.
Yeah,
the appeal process letter, I know I got my one copy, I think I sent to Wayne, and so I don't have one. But Wayne was looking at it. And our concern with the appeal process, which we, again, need to be looked at, and Wayne is well aware of this, that we felt that some of the wording was a little too not negative, but just strict and not very open in terms of you had to appeal by, you know, this, you had 5 days. And we wanted to remove that kind of feeling from the letter. And we wanted certainly these appeals to happen in a timely fashion, but not that if you miss these 5 days, you're out. The appeal process, I think, was just sort of stating you will contact the principal, but you're right, you need to see the letter. I had one copy. Wayne didn't even have a copy of it in his file, and that was being looked at.
Okay. I still would like to see the parent input. form that
goes through. I think we need a package of all the forms that have to do with this process, because now, thinking about what we were just talking about that input form goes to the next year's teacher, in the guideline it says, at the end of the third quarter, parents will be invited to provide information which will assist in placement.
Yeah, I
so we need to
work
this through, the various different types of input, because there are three different kinds we were really
For instance, one of the things that has happened from a practical point of view, the input sheet is certainly processed right now and can be useful for that balanced classroom consideration. But it was also part of our initial discussion that parents who felt that their input was not directly going to the choice of the teacher for the next year on a one-on-one basis, we also realized how important it would be for the receiving teacher to get that kind of information, not knowing the child and so forth and so on. So that what we need to think through here and be really absolutely clear about, does the one sheet serve two purposes? Does it go through two hands? Does it get rooted? And if so, does that make sense? So we need to be sure, check on that one. I think most of the rest of this is relatively on target with what this is, and also what my recollection of the discussion leading up to it. So let me know.
Yeah, I think the board does need to see the appeal process letter, the kindergarten placement letters. And actually, if we're working on that letter, that'll give, or that form that will give parents a chance to comment on the curriculum of the year they're currently in. Mm-hmm. I think that would be helpful for everybody to see, just as one package.
I think it's important to stress to parents that this is a way for them to be involved in the process. The feedback that I've gotten is that parents feel out of the loop, that something was taken away from them. And I think psychologically, getting all this information at the same time when you are requested to go to a conference, or you can make the choice whether you want to have the conference, kind of plays into parents who have to make the choice whether to request a conference or not, feeling put out of the loop. That there still seems to be a lot of feeling that if you're not set up for a conference, that you're missing something, that you have to make the special request. And I think it probably is nice to have teachers have a chance to talk to the parents of kids who have had good years. I mean, it's too bad to have spring conferences just sort of be what solve all the problems. But I'm getting feedback that the two things are happening and at the same time, and it's not positive, that it brings up those old feelings.
Yeah,
I think that's something that needs to be worked through, because the whole point of changing that was to divorce placement from a discussion of your child.
Right, but the divorce has quite happened.
So we need to keep working.
I guess the feedback I've had about the conferences is people felt much more comfortable this year, even if they weren't requested for a conference, that they just said, if I want one, I will ask for one. And the teachers are happy to give one, and if I don't want one, I'm fine. And it's okay to ask, and you don't feel you have to walk through the halls and wonder, you know, why somebody's there. I had much more positive feelings.
Well, you know, it's interesting because the feedback that I've gotten is from were a lot of people whose children were in first grade and haven't necessarily been part of the system and gone along with the system, and so they're feeling, well, should I or shouldn't I?
Yeah, well, I would
maybe
just...
who are having...
Well, again, in some ways, we just don't give enough information to make people understand. I mean, because those forms are set up for people who know the system, because we discussed it at length last year.
Right.
And if you weren't part of those discussions because you weren't in the system or you were very early in the system,
you
don't have that. And I do think we have to be very careful about the tone of the letters, and you know, take every opportunity we can to reaffirm what we're trying to do.
Information is great, but the mailing, as I remember it, was for kindergarten anyway, it was the progress report, there was three different pieces, I think the principal search comments, so there's a lot of things in one envelope that maybe somehow that needs to be spread out a little bit, if possible.
Divorce the progress report from the placement.
Perhaps, it's just a lot of information that, that was requested on one, one mailing.
Well, that's valuable to help.
Keep sorting it through. I don't think anybody thinks it's perfect yet.
No.
Probably never will be perfect, but at least we're trying.
Well, we, oh, sorry, I was going to say, we can gather everything that needs to be on here. I'm not sure it's everything we want to adopt into our policy manual, but certainly everybody should be provided with those things. And it would be the appeal process, the letter about input. Was there another piece?
Kindergarten.
Kindergarten.
Screening.
I don't think there was a letter. I'm just trying to remember. I don't think you go to the kindergarten orientation night and you're given oral, you know, information, but you don't, you just get a letter inviting you to the kindergarten orientation evening, and then you bring it home and you have your medical forms and all your forms to fill out. And it just says a date you will be notified of your teacher. It's not.
There used to be a letter explaining the screening process before you went to screening. Is there still such a thing?
Yeah.
Is that?
You didn't get yours back.
No, I did. I didn't go, but I did get mine.
I was going to ask if you went.
We spend a great deal of time discussing how much information, what specificity in the information. I was a little concerned at one point about the bulk of the information, because you can flood people, and they begin to ask questions on the questions. But I think that was pretty thorough. I had a number of parents come to me that evening and say this was very helpful. It answered a lot of our questions. In fact, one of the themes of our thinking was to pre-answer as many of the questions that the staff, far better than I, and Jan Love, because she's so deeply involved in it, clerically, anticipate or have experienced. And so we try to give a lot of information in the packet with, without overwhelming, but also to answer a lot of questions in our discussion during the evening, both with a full group and then in classrooms. And I got the impression that for the most part we covered the bases fairly well there, but it was so much that I felt kind of badly on the one hand, so much information going about kindergarten programming, kindergarten entry screening, orientation evening, busing, lunch. Well, I guess lunch wasn't in there. They get mixed up between the sets now, but and just there was a lot of information. But I think basically it came out okay. We had some really nice comments from parents that evening about how thorough this was. So that felt good.
I think particularly for people where their kindergartner is their oldest child, they want all that stuff. It's their first year involved in the school. I don't know, when it's new, people love getting all that stuff.
Yes.
It's true.
By the time they hit sophomore, hold it for long.
I think we can all remember the anxiety. Our first child going to kindergarten. The rest is sort of a blur.
Yep.
But that first one, you do remember.
Yeah,
maybe
true.
Your last. But you might remember your last.
No, I only remember the first.
I will get whatever kindergarten information is on it. But it didn't go into great detail.
There's no input other than their medical.
No, experience. There's no input except for.
Ann had said something about kindergarten that was wrong.
Well, we talked about kindergarten because kindergarten placement will be carried out by the administration. That's the last point on there, as opposed to by the kindergarten team placing those children.
Charlie, I'm sorry. I wasn't quite sure what you meant by input there.
No. We were talking about the type of parent input or parent requests
for kindergarten entry.
You don't get that parental input form that we get for our other children.
We do. In the packet, that's another thing that was in there. In the packet was a letter on one side, and the flip side, and it refers to it on the front side. Flip side is a whole series of questions that the staff have really carefully thought out and sort of sequenced, asking for information about the child to help us in preparing class groupings.
Send me the whole packet.
Yeah.
It's everything. All right, so we're...
Are there other feedback on this? I think the first bullet needs to be worked on a little bit, and then certainly all that information. Are there any other input for us to... Okay.
Probably not until they see the rest, right?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. New business, personnel request. First is consideration of the superintendent's nominations for continuing contract teachers.
And in your packet, I included the following list for continuing contracts. Paula Borelli, school nurse. Mary Dulac, third grade. Nancy Miles, special education. Those three are at Pine Cove School. Middle school, Paige Brown, French teacher. David Farrick, special education. Therese Lemansky, eighth grade. Craig Roberts, seventh grade. Tammy Stanley, special education. And at the high school, Gordon Crosby, Spanish, and Dwight Ely, social studies. Those are nominations for going on to continuing contract. Want me to read, go right on to the probationary?
Fine, yeah.
Okay, you can make one motion if you wish. Following list are second year probationary teacher contracts. Pine Cove School, Linda Alfiero, kindergarten. Joshua Olens, first grade. Allison Hawks, third grade. Deborah Twombly, fourth grade. Middle school, Claudine Bravo, Spanish. Laurie Turley, music teacher. Stephen Price, sixth grade. Jamie Michaud, eighth grade. And at the high school, Sarah Franklin, English teacher. Amy Russell, English teacher. Hannah Ashley, social studies teacher. Norm Richardson, junior music teacher. Carrie Curtis, chemistry teacher. And Tony Giudoni, math teacher. I should note that particularly at the high school, you have a number of positions that are part-time positions, but we did not note those because for contract purposes, it is sufficient to list them, and they are signed specific contracts for specific duties.
I'd entertain a motion. Charlie?
I move acceptance of the superintendent's nominations for teachers for going on to continuing contracted as listed and second year probationary teacher contracts as listed for the 1995-1996 school year.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All in favor? 7-0.
Thank you. And next I have a retirement, one that with people who have the kind of record of service that this person has, it's always with mixed feelings that you talk about retirement. Happy to see somebody reach a point in life where they can stop and smell the roses and play with the grandkids and all that kind of thing, but still in all will be a loss. Sam Boothie, after 30 years, has decided that the time has come to play with his grandsons and enjoy life a little more. Or I don't think I should really say that. He's always going to miss the kids here and teaching and being part of that and all the other kinds of things, but enjoying another aspect of life with a little more leisure. So we will miss him. Thank him tremendously for all his many, many contributions, and wish him well. But he is retiring. You want to stop there, or you want me? Yeah. There's a resignation listed, but actually, I'm going to pass by that one.
Okay. All right. I'd entertain a motion on that.
Yeah. I'd like to make a motion that we accept the retirement. Is it a retirement resignation?
It's a retirement.
Retirement of Sam Boothie.
Second.
Who's second?
Gail.
Well, Charlie.
Probably Gail and I are the only ones on this board whose children have been served by Sam, both on the athletic field and in the classroom. And I think some of us have also dealt with him this year in negotiations. And it just seems appropriate that his resignation is so concise and short, but it speaks a lot for the person. He's quiet, but he really reaches out and makes people feel comfortable, and I think children students learn, and I think he's well respected by his peers.
Mm-hmm.
And he will be greatly missed.
I had a call from a former board member today who said, I want someone to make a motion not to accept. I thought that was pretty good. I said, well, I don't know if we can do that to him.
Can I just say something? As a department head, Sam has been a tremendous help to me in my second year in the high school as principal. And one of the things I can say is that his enthusiasm for teaching and being with kids is as strong now as it was 30 years ago. And I know it was a real tough decision for Sam to make, but we are losing someone whose enthusiasm is tremendously strong, and it really permeates throughout the building, and he's been a tremendous help to me and to his department, and we will miss him greatly. So, thank you.
And he's been a prime mover for the implementation of the Chicago math mm-hmm. curriculum. And
well, he's been a pleasure to work with this year. We've dealt with him on the negotiating team, and he's a gracious and steadying influence mm. on some of those of us who talk a little too much. All in favor?
Reluctantly.
7-0.
Thank you. We have two requests for halftime positions and bringing back Ingrid Stressinger. Brought a request to remain at the halftime position or teaching one section of kindergarten. We tabled it until this meeting when we have at least adopted the budget and we have a sense of pre-registrations at the kindergarten level. My recommendation to you is that we can continue with this situation because the number of kindergartners we have enrolled will require the 8 sections. Which means that we can continue to use the halftime position that we carried this year and match it with this halftime position. So if you.
Since I tabled the position, I will move acceptance of the halftime position for the 1995-96 school year.
Second. Beth? Any discussion? Excuse me, I have a really sore throat, so if I seem to be losing it. Any discussion? All in favor? 7-0.
Thank you. Now the next, we actually have another request which you just received. I had a chance to talk to a couple of you understanding that it was probably coming in. What we have here really are two issues. We understand that our part-time art position at the high school will be open. I don't have a formal letter on that one, so I'm not listing it formally, but it is my understanding that that will be open. And that being aware of that in a small department, Mary Hart has submitted a letter requesting that she move into the part-time position. She explains that she, as a practicing artist, she has really missed not having the time to do her own work, would like to work part-time, and furthermore, would see this as opening up the full-time position, that we have had some concerns as to the full range of services in the art department, particularly where we had such a concentration in photography in the part-time position. Whether or not we would continue to carry some photography would be dependent on the discussions we would have with candidates. I might also point out, of course, in our budget discussion, we talked about a concern that there would be no services available for art in kindergarten. If we are to move forward in this direction, then a full-time person could be hired who, with the understanding there might be at least some consideration of helping set up some kind of art supervision at the kindergarten level. I don't know that we could promise actually teaching on a regular process because I think that would be problematic given the schedules at the high school, but perhaps we would have somebody coming in who had the interest and ability to talk about how we would address those needs. With that in mind, I have not had an opportunity Rick and I've had some preliminary discussions. I haven't had an opportunity to talk to Mary. Is it your sense that she wants to move on this permanently? Because when we have this kind of request, we always run into this problem. We have somebody who was on a full-time contract. Technically, the usual way of dealing with that when somebody wants to work part-time for a year is regarded as a request to move to part-time for one year.
She did not lead me to believe that it was a temporary situation, that she would like to part-time permanently. And she would like to teach two sections of, she does sculpturing and also areas of the, I guess, three-dimensional type of art, as well as maybe an advanced studio art class. So my interpretation of her request is for that.
Well, I would advise the board to deal with it under that sense. Clearly, we can have some conversations to clarify that, and there are some contract issues that I would want to make sure we were putting all together. But what you have in front of you is a request from a current staff member to remain a current staff member to work at the reduced time or the three-fifths position.
Can we do that without having anything formal from the...
Well, that's awkward. We don't have it in writing. It's certainly our understanding, yes.
She told me she submitted it today or yesterday.
We have
no,
hers.
No, we have from hers. The other art
position.
Making a move on Mary Hart's proposal without having anything...
Certainly not be back. <It's applicant>.
Yes, well...
We seem to have a paperwork issue here.
Yeah, that's... I don't like to hold up decisions for, you know, what appear to be bureaucratic issues. On the other hand, I think what the board can do, what you can do tonight, you can indicate a willingness to discuss this and to entertain this. Then Rick and I will work out the details and we'll bring it back for firm vote in May. I think if we are able to, we can move forward at this point with some indication from you as to whether you would entertain this request.
I think what this request does, it opens up the flexibility of moving from someone who is single task oriented in curriculum delivery to being able to hire someone who's more flexible and multifaceted. And therefore, I would support this, even though it's with regret because I think she's, you know,
well, she's exceptional.
Exceptional.
It's true. On the other hand...
But we still retain the elements that she's the most successful at. So, okay.
Is there any other opinion?
The only problem with the art department in the past is that we've kind of focused the curriculum around the talents of the particular person that we have in hand. And I would want to steer away from that. Bring in someone who has more general art experiences, multifaceted.
Well, it's always a mixed problem because we have certainly had some dandy people. Unfortunately, of course, they're also practicing artists, and this is not untypical of what we've had at the high school, so it's a mixed problem. I think what we then, from this discussion, can go back to Mary and tell her that the board certainly will entertain this, and we'll just clean up the details and be a little more specific about it and bring it back again in May.
Okay. Okay.
And your other request, this is a consideration request for a leave of absence for next year. And it certainly is, again, from an outstanding teacher, Ogden Williams. Perhaps from the standpoint of clarity, I could read this in case somebody is listening. I don't know if anybody's watching for it at 5 minutes of 10.
No, you never know.
Well, they do play them again, of
they
course.
They get to see it in the morning. And yeah.
It's true. It does get replayed.
Days, so.
So since Ogden certainly writes clearly and well, and I probably can do as well by reading his letter than trying to paraphrase it. After mulling the matter over for some time, I'm requesting a leave of absence for the 1995-96 school year. I have two main reasons for this request. Primarily, I want to teach my own two children for a year. I do not want to come to the end of my teaching career having spent my time and energy teaching other people's children without having offered the similar efforts to my own. My second reason is professional.
In the interest of maintaining vitality and freshness in my teaching approach, I want to experience entirely new challenges for a year. I'm excited by the notion of creating a new one-year curriculum for children in an unfamiliar new setting at different grade levels than what I normally experience. I should inform you that I intend to take on other students, perhaps 4 or 5, if I find other families willing to pay for the sort of educational experience I envision. He goes on to explain how he would see that going. Please understand this request of mine indicates no reflection of my opinions about the quality of education in our schools. I am proud both to support and to teach in the Cape Elizabeth school system. I know that what I plan to do will broaden and revitalize me as a teacher. I hope my experiences in this learning experiment will tend to make me a more useful member of the Pond Cove community. Thank you for considering my request. Ogden Williams.
Any comments?
In the students that now are homeschooled, what kind of support do we give?
Homeschooling?
Because he is a member of our community. I mean, he lives in our community.
So right.
Or he would somehow have some connection with.
Well, it's been my experience over the years that everybody profits by having a friendly and open exchange among homeschooling parents and the school. That is, if we have materials, books that are extra for whatever reason. We cannot take books away from students that are in our class for parents who choose to do homeschooling, but we almost always are able to find some accommodation if people have asked us for materials. Frequently, they don't. I mean, people who choose to homeschool often have materials available to them from other sources and do not request that. So in that sense, we have sometimes, and I'm trying to think, because I've had more experience with requests. I had more experience with requests in Gorham than I have had here to share materials. I used to sometimes have students who would come in for part of a day. They might come in for an art experience or a gym experience. After all, they are students in the school. Excuse me, in the town. The one thing I have found that is problematic, a busy teacher with a classroom here really should not be asked to duplicate services for parents who choose to homeschool. And we have sometimes had some issues where, and I can't think of any in this town, but I do remember some conversations in other places that I've worked. Other than that, frankly, it's been a very friendly interchange, and we do try to be supportive.
But numbers are growing, because when I first came on the board, we had no one, and we now have 8.
Mm-hmm. I think that there's a very interesting literature growing on homeschooling. It is a growing phenomenon in many respects. Many people homeschool for a year or two and find that it suits their lifestyle to send their children back to the public schools, but some do not. There are sometimes clusters of homeschooling families who support each other. The change in the regulations on that do require some kind of support mechanism. In other words, you are supposed to be in touch with either various networks that support homeschooling or a certified teacher. Obviously, Ogden certainly fulfills that. And other than that, there is very little, frankly, that the state requires. A program of study, which is sent directly to Augusta, and a copy is left in my office.
Are there any guidelines for this request?
You mean for the homeschooling part or for the...
For the request for a leave of absence for a year.
Leaves of absence are handled by the board on an ad hoc one-by-one basis on the merits of each one separately. Usually the issue is for boards is how readily can we assure our parents of an ongoing quality experience even if this teacher is not there. The request basically is not costing you money. However, you are in a position of hiring somebody for 1 year because you are, if you grant the leave, you've left the job opportunity available.
at this grade level. That's not the problem it would be if you had a request from a high school chemistry teacher, for instance. That very different availability of suitable candidates.
You know, I think that the question in my mind is a very capable teacher who's done some innovative things with students that has also impacted his peers who have modeled some of the things he's done. And he's looking for some way of rejuvenating himself, and somewhere in our mechanism, because he hasn't been here the number of years that he needs to apply for a sabbatical. You know, it just, I'm leery about leaves of absence for, you know, teachers who haven't been here long. And I know as one board member who has voted for those in the past, and those teachers have not returned. And, you know, that concerns me. How do you support the person who evidently needs some time but doesn't fall into the contractual reasons for the right request? You know, to me, this should be a sabbatical versus a leave of absence.
Well, he doesn't qualify by That's the right. contract for a sabbatical, and yet he certainly is connecting it to his professional growth as well as his interest in a personal nature.
If nobody else has any comments, I'd like to make some comments. These are very personal comments, and I'm not saying them for the purpose of trying to change how anybody is personally feeling about this issue. I consider Ogden a friend. I respect him highly as a teacher. My daughter had him last year. It was just a wonderful experience for her. A wonderful experience for our whole family, and she still enjoys showing off the books that they published and that kind of thing, and she still calls Ogden the most, you know, awesome teacher, and I'm sure she always will. My problem with this request, I've been really agonizing over this for a few days, you know, since we first got it, and I feel very strongly that these unpaid leaves should really be for only the most extenuating circumstances and real hardship cases that would come up only in extraordinary circumstances. The reason I feel that way is because there are no guidelines on, you know, what we can and can't or cannot accept. So it is a very subjective process. And I just have always, you know, tried to make the test be, would I accept this from a teacher who I had no respect for, assuming there was such a teacher, you know, as opposed to one, you know, I personally think is a good teacher. And I just don't feel that this request falls into the category that would allow me to accept it. Because I don't think he's doing something that he wants, and it's a, you know, it's a personal life decision he's making. There is no counterbalancing benefit to the system that is built in, and that's why, you know, I agree with Charlie that the whole idea of a sabbatical is a much cleaner process because it has you have to apply. Your application is reviewed by a committee. There are some commitments back and forth between the applicant and the system, and some commitment in terms of coming back for at least 1 year. And I certainly think this is a system that needs to move ahead with, and we are trying to, really helping teachers to develop themselves personally and professionally. And I guess what I'd like to see is if we could work on changing contract language so it wasn't 7 years, so that we had more flexibility in that, in who we will grant a sabbatical for. But I like the idea of having that kind of process that protects the interests of everybody.
Okay.
Because when we sit here and make these decisions, we're not just making them, you know, for us and what makes us feel good. And it's, you know, it's hard to say no to somebody who you know is a very good teacher. But, you know, we're representing the system as a whole and what's a good, you know, what's a good way to move the system ahead. And I just feel like we don't have enough guidelines for dealing with these leaves that make sure that we apply some kind of consistent standard. So very regretfully, I'm going to vote no.
When someone applies, I just want to clarify myself on the rules. When they apply for a sabbatical, it's implicit that they're returning. Is that correct?
It's stated.
They're making a commitment to return for at least 1 year.
And when someone applies for a leave of absence, that's not necessarily?
It is the usual expectation, and I should clarify that in my conversation with Ogden, he did state his intention to return.
Is that what makes this different from, say, a resignation?
Well, what makes it different from resignation is that the teacher is considered to be an employee on leave. We generally, where's Scott? I guess he's still upstairs. We generally, if requested to do so, maintain, for instance, benefits. People pay the fee, but at the same time, it's an important consideration that you're still considered part of the, you know, the school community. It is usually, I mean, we can't think of a time when we haven't had an expectation that somebody would return either from sabbatical. Since you're paying some half of somebody's salary, there's usually a sense of a stronger moral obligation. People would feel more likely to. But in either way, is there any way of forcing somebody to do that? And frankly, I have seen over the years, I have seen a few sabbaticals, people didn't come back.
Is this just a verbal commitment to come back?
Yes, but even if it were in writing, I have to tell you in all honesty, it's like any contract, there is no real penalty for breaking it, and things do happen, and I've never personally thought it was in everybody's best interest to force a job relationship when somebody decides they don't want to be here.
Which is what might happen if we don't vote for this. You know, next year he's not going to want to be here. I wonder what that would
be. I would guess that that Ogden has made up his mind what he's going to do. He would like to do it with this framework. And your choices are to hear his case and believe that, you know, he is certainly, he's making a professional judgment that what he's doing will be, in fact, professionally enriching. Knowing Ogden, I would agree with him. It will be professionally enriching. If there are other issues that are troubling you, I can't make up your mind for you, but it is an unusual request. I certainly understand that. I understand you're being presented with a situation, particularly since he's very upfront and tells you that he would probably like to broaden his teaching to include perhaps a few other students. It's almost as if you could almost say you were thinking about it as setting up a small charter school, for which we have absolutely no rules and no guidance and no way of knowing how to shape it. So I can appreciate that that's a difficult situation for you to be in. But professionally, I can certainly support the concept that he will be growing and learning, and in that sense, it is a professional.
See, I see it as a temporary career change in the aspect that he's not taking a leave to further his education or that kind of thing, because he doesn't fall into the sabbatical qualifications. I think within the system, if he needs to teach a different level, that the options are there. I think there are options there if he feels burnt out at what he's doing now and feels he needs to serve. So therefore, I find the request hard to support. I understand his reasonings, but from a system-wide approach and a board-level approach, I can't support it.
The only thing I'm thinking is that if we assume that if we don't approve it, then he might not be here next year anyway, it's sort of like a choice of having him leave or having him leave with the chance of getting him back again.
I guess that's a dilemma we all have to deal with. Like I said, I was dealing with mine just personally. I've tried very hard over the 4 years to be very consistent about my thinking on that and to not personalize it to one person, but to try to think about the best way of running the system. And I think what this shows to me is that we need to have some process for helping teachers who need, you know, some kind of refreshment or, you know, development that protects all parties. Right now, the system gives all and is hanging out there. And we have been, I'm not saying Ogden would, but we have had, you know, assurances, you know, many times from people, oh, we'll be back and it'll be the end of August, and they decide not to come back. That puts, you know, that's a hardship on the system, the kids, you know, who are supposed to go into that class, you know, on and on. So, but it's my personal thing, so.
I'm not sure that we can look at it with, is he going to come back or isn't he going to come back? I don't think you can ever do that, and I know it's hard when you get burned, but you do. I mean, I feel I would have to operate on some faith. I don't remember exactly how you said it, but I guess I would respond to his first reason. I mean, his children are at the age of his teaching skills, and they're not going to be there forever. So, you know, as a personal reason, I can understand that. And it's a dilemma, but I think I will support this. I think that professionally that we will probably gain from it.
In general, I like to, when possible, support teacher requests. I certainly understand the experience that you previously had, and I might be willing to, since this is my first opportunity to go out for a limb, and then if I got burned, then I would be sitting there saying, I did this once before and it didn't work. But at this point, I would tend to support teacher requests whenever we possibly can.
You ready to move on this one? Somebody want to make a motion?
I make a motion that we give a year's leave of absence to Ogden Williams for the 1995-96 school year.
Second.
Any discussion? Say again, with great regret, I'm doing what I'm doing, considering the individual.
Pardon?
All in favor?
Same.
I said, with great regret, I'm doing this. Okay. Five. All opposed? Two.
Thank you. Motion carries.
The next item is policy's first reading. I think we just have the one, right?
Yeah, we have just the one, the field trips. It doesn't have a number. I think somewhere it has a number. Is it ICA, probably? Would be the field trip policy number. The other policy that was included in your packet, which was a IICAR, was one we were working on, and we have chosen not to pursue, so it's just the field trips policy. And this came from a lot of sample policies that we looked at. We tried to take a lot of pieces from a lot of different school systems to come up with one that fit the CAPE system. And it is our first shot at it, so we'd love to have as much input as possible.
Charlie.
Under the school board will receive annual notification in September of out-of-state and overnight field trips, which are regularly scheduled as part of the established curriculum. Are we talking?
Chewonky.
Hmm?
Chewonky was one.
And are we talking any kind of sports?
No, this is just the extensions of classroom field trips. We are then at the next meeting going to look at athletic field trips.
Good.
But so you need to separate that out.
We should probably say non-athletic.
What?
And it probably should be clarified as such, because that was the first thing I was thinking of.
Yeah, we were hoping the first paragraph did that, but it may not enough. So we could add school-related or...
just non-athletic.
Non-athletic.
What did you...
Well, she did say co-curricular. I just had missed that, but...
I mean, just, it's not very glamorous.
But even co-curricular's gotten us into some hot water.
That's the usual way. It's just to label it non-athletic.
Just leave it field trips, non-athletic.
And then you have non-athletic. That's common.
We still need to address the athletic ones, and we're not quite there yet.
I have a question about the second paragraph stating field trips must be completed within 1 day, and then any other field trips that are going to be overnight. So that seems like it's in conflict.
I guess the rationale there that normal field trips that we talk about are the kids going to the apple orchard or the kids going to a play and those kind of things. But that we do recognize that there are other field trips out there. And I think we discussed, was there a trip to Boston or there was a trip, the foreign language trips, those kind of things that have been happening as a normal part of our curriculum, that we would get presented in September with a list of those. But then anything that fell out of those normal ones, we would then have to have brought to us later on. It is a little confusing.
I guess it's the strength of the statement, field trips must be completed within 1 day.
You can say
to make it suggests
should be completed
or except as specified below, something like that.
Yeah. Field trips are usually completed within 1 day, maybe, or something. We will work on
Sort of leeway.
Well, do you even need that sentence at all? I mean, if you just had the first sentence in the second paragraph and then went on with all the clarifications.
I think we want to stress that most field trips are just 1 day during normal school hours. We're not encouraging a huge amount of other things, a field trip. But we do recognize that there are these other things that go on.
Well, maybe you could move that up into the first paragraph. It's a nice clean depth. That first sentence in the second paragraph is a nice clean statement of what a field trip is, and then it gets kind of muddied when you...
I think we can work on that second sentence to try to make it work.
Any other comments on this? That no, or are people reading? No, all done with this one?
Yes, yes.
All right.
I've gone on to the other one.
Right.
Looking at this,
we're not going to look at that.
Can it state something like classroom and or course field trip? Because I think in terms of, say, the one-act plays, how a team wins a tournament here, and then the next weekend are invited to East Millinocket overnight, it would not give me as a principal the opportunity to come to the board for some sort of approval of an overnight. When you talk about athletic, I still have other co-curricular situations that may occur that do not come under the heading of athletics. And how would you like me to deal with those kinds of things?
Okay, I understand that problem. I'll try to work something out at the next policy meeting.
Rick, I do think it would be helpful, though, if, when we have, like, the one acts or something, we know what could happen if they moved on. And if we, had some idea of if they win this, this will happen and this will happen, I think that would be helpful.
I
And the speech and debate.
Yeah, the whole thing, including national championships and all that.
Well, that can happen in music.
Yep.
Right.
I mean, there are a number.
I mean, if we're going to be in particular.
But if they know they're going to do the competition, and that's the.
Those are the possibilities.
That's when you get into an arena somewhat like the athletic issues, where you have interscholastic. So you have, I mean, I guess the common thread there is really the competitive nature of some of those. Well, I don't know, but again, it's a little different with band performances or something. But we need to consider that. We can do that at the next policy meeting or before that.
Not tonight.
Okay.
And you now have a music director who's at the high school who's starting to take.
True. That's what's making me think of it.
Yeah. Okay. Moving on to the draft calendar for 1995-96.
I have had notification but not discussion since I've been sort of wandering around between Augusta and here. But I had a note yesterday from the association regarding a half-day workshop before the spring conference. I think it's the discussion we started to get into with the placement situation. And I would have to ask the building principal to give me some feedback as to the number of conferences that are being held in the spring at Pond Cove. But apparently the association has registered a request to reconsider the half-day workshop before the spring conference. Again, I haven't had a chance to discuss that. It was a telephone message left for me, but I don't want not to let you know that notice. I will talk it through and see what exactly that's all about. But it's my understanding that request has been put in.
It would be helpful in that regard to know, as you said, how many conferences were held and how many people who weren't initially told that they should have one requested one.
But we can get that data.
Right.
They asked for a whole day. They said a whole day.
Well, we do have a whole day.
We already have.
Meaning the second?
It's see, that's part of the problem.
Not me.
I guess.
Yeah. We do have a whole day. Was it the date that the whole day was? Or was, I thought it was.
It was an addition?
There's no date in April.
There's no whole day.
It's May 3rd.
It's changed.
May 3rd
oh,
was
May 3rd,
the date.
Okay.
Yeah. That was intended to be. I see. Okay. All right. Then I will clarify that and get back to you.
I think we did that anticipating that Pond Cove may go to a trimester system.
Yeah, that was my understanding.
Okay.
Okay, I'll clarify that with the association and see just exactly what it is they had in mind.
Yeah, the thinking was that it would be desirable from some people's standpoint to have Pond Cove and the middle school be on, both be on trimesters. There was no feedback from middle school and actually from Clark for the union that's, you know, the trimester works well.
Yep.
As a parent with a middle schooler, I must say, I think it works a lot better than the quarters. It's a little less labor intensive and the timing of feedback is very good. So it would be good if we could have at least two schools on the same kind of schedule.
That'd be nice.
That'd be a real plus.
On the bottom of this draft calendar, where it mentions two other tentative additional workshop days, are those one or the other as a tentative day, or both?
No, it would be both, subject to the formal ratification of the discussions coming from negotiations.
And those would be training sorts of days?
Right. Staff development.
Right.
Protected staff development days.
It's a long school vacation.
Would that affect this 175 days?
Yes, it adds to them.
Yeah, it's not in there because it hasn't been agreed upon yet, and Connie would have to rework the entire calendar just for that. So that's just for us to keep in mind that's if we did add those 2 days. Yeah. That's where we're, you know, this is one proposal of where they would go. We did have quite a bit of discussion about where they should go. The teachers wanted them somewhat close together so that if they started working on something, you know, they could continue it sometime not 2 months down the road, right?
And they also wanted them within the first, at least two-thirds of this school year, that things in the last third of the year, people are more on a wind down, and you don't want to start up big projects. So they requested that they be, you know, as early in the year as, you know, as we could, and we looked at that hard.
And also trying not to, you know, again, the chronic problem is having very split up weeks. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so trying to kind of concentrate breaks.
Would that change the pupil attendance days to 173?
No.
It would just
pupil attendance days remains the same. It would mean the teacher in-service days would go from 5 to 7.
Mm-hmm. So it's a little confusing because these numbers just haven't been changed yet because it hasn't happened.
Be interesting, the administrative guidelines for exceptional requests bordering a vacation.
But those days wouldn't be able to be taken.
Oh, true, but it limits.
Right, that's true.
Both coming and going.
Well, I will make a comment, not so much as a board member, but as a working parent, that I find adding a day on each end of a vacation problematic. For people who have to find alternative care for their child anyhow, to add two more days is hard.
They would be added anywhere in the year.
Right, but you can, you know, you find somebody for pot of time and you're adding two more days onto a particular time.
The thing that's different about this, and Sue isn't here, but the buildings will be open. I'm not sure community services, that care couldn't be running at those
times. If community services will cover the days, that's great.
Yeah, we haven't discussed that, and I probably should.
Sort of like adding some.
Sue left a little early.
Somebody with that. I do know that Sue has made those offers. However, you know,
it would be open. Oh, you're all set on that? Okay.
You didn't hear that request,
Priscilla,
from me.
We really discussed the working parents, and we thought it's almost easier to do it in one hunk, as opposed to if we put then the day, 1 week, another day in January, another day, then they're just you know, it's difficult wherever you do it.
I'm responding to you as a working parent saying it's not.
It's better just in the middle of a month somewhere?
Well, I mean, yeah, I'm sure that you're going to find just as many parents saying yes, and I guess the community services is there, but knowing that you have to cover a whole week, a lot of people piece things together, a lot of people do swaps, and it's just adding another thing. I mean, maybe also what we're going to find is that people will say, okay, well, I'm going on February vacation, I'm leaving the 14th, and I'm coming back the 28th. You know, I think that there are a lot of ramifications around spacing 2 days around vacation.
Yeah, we just felt it for the kids. It's a wind down period anyway, and then a start up. And, you know, looking at the fall and into February when you add snow days and things in there, there's just were no full weeks that we could hit, and we wanted to get them in before March. Add two more days is actually quite difficult.
Oh, I'm sure it is.
I guess I would vote more for the 15th, 16th, and come back on the 26th.
They felt they needed the days separated so they could process knowledge, too.
Well, you know? I have trouble with the 26th. I think that's a tough day to come back and go to a workshop and have one more day on a holiday week.
Of course, we could go to year-round calendar.
Yeah, you know, that's the thing. This is kind of a forerunner of when we have longer breaks. This is a pretty baby step here. That's probably going to happen. Your kids would be out of school.
I can so be
you
hard
don't have to worry about it. It's hard.
Other point, which it's, you know, February is the snowiest month in the month of May. What do we do if they get snowed out on those 2 days? Do we move them?
Well, that's a good question. There has to be an answer, and I don't have it.
They might have to go to the end, just like all the rest of them. Rest of the days. I mean, you can't, you know.
My advice would be to for those of you who haven't really, you know, some of you talked this over and made some choices, the rest of you, we don't have to adopt this tonight. This is going to be adopted in May. There's also an opportunity. I need to get back to the association and kind of see exactly what it was they had in their minds. And maybe there's a better solution, but I like to remind boards that, you know, the days are going to fall somewhere, and they're usually just got to make a choice, and
yeah, just take a little time and look at it, and if anybody has any good ideas, we'd love to hear them.
Maybe it's just on my copy, but this doesn't have anything to do about the added teacher days. It goes back to the trimester in the middle school. The progress report times are listed for the first and second trimester, but not the third trimester. And I believe that would be right around April 26th, which if the thinking was that May 3rd would be the spring conference day, that coincides with the data that we collected as part of the fifth grade project. For parents to have information prior to the conference without setting out yet another piece of paperwork that people have to add to. It's a natural flow of the paperwork that we use. Just as in October, you will notice the progress reports go home October 20th, and if we follow past suit and use the 26th and 27th as family conference days, they would have that information prior to. But I just, on my copy, it wasn't noted that it would be the 26th, and I believe that might help some people with the understanding of why May 3rd was chosen as a conference date. I wasn't at the meeting, but I'm just guessing.
You're right.
That's right.
That's right. Okay. Sleep on it.
Okay.
Nominations for athletic fee spring coaching positions. Says for 94-95, I guess that means 95.
Well, it means spring 95, as far as I know. Yep, spring 95. JV softball, Tony Giadone, baseball assistant, Dan LaGage, 7th and 8th grade tennis, Rachel Garrett, 7th and 8th grade boys track, Paul Casey, 7th and 8th grade girls track, Teresa Lemansky, 7th and 8th grade lacrosse, Charlie Carroll, halftime, and another halftime position for Chris Carlisle. 8th grade softball, Carrie Curtis. 7th grade softball, Paige Bram. 8th grade baseball, Craig Roberts. And 7th grade baseball, Doug Brown.
I'll make a motion that we accept the superintendent's nominations for athletic fee positions for spring 95.
Second. Any discussion? Brown?
I just sort of wanted to make a comment just to clarify for anyone who might be listening that hears this list and doesn't necessarily understand that these are for this spring and it's already in this year's budget.
True. Okay. All in favor? 7-0. All right, well, I'd entertain a motion to go into executive session for the purpose of discussing negotiations with the administrator.
So moved.
Unit.
Second.
Second. All in favor?
0. What if we all voted no? Then we can go home.